Hello, friends. As much as it pains me to do this, I have to begin this episode with a disclaimer. First of all, this is a spoiler-filled recap of Season 2 Episodes 1 and 2 of Mr. Robot. As always with our Mr. Robot rewatch podcasts, our hosts are talking about the episodes in the context of the whole show, so if you haven't seen all 4 seasons of Mr. Robot, on your own head be it. Secondly, Craig was so excited to be back podcasting that he forgot to soundcheck his microphone for the recording of this episode. As a result, the audio sounded like a fucking Mersbo concert bootleg. If you don't understand that reference, it means it was very, very loud. We've worked very hard to make it listenable, but apologies for the less than stellar sound quality. Craig is spending the next week watching basketball as punishment. That's a joke about the episode you're about to listen to. Please enjoy.
Hello and welcome to fSobriety. I am Craig Woods, and if this is your best idea for a podcast, I should not be the one resigning. And wipe your goddamn face.
I'm James Hamilton, and I don't really know why I'm laughing. I thought you'd made some joke I didn't get, and I usually fake laugh at those.
I'm Alan Todd, and Che Guevara is thrown up in his face.
Guys, this is us back for 2022. Can you believe it? First podcast of the year. Let's hope it's a good one. By which I mean the episode and not the year, because I've given up hope for the year being good.
Let's hope we remember how to do a podcast.
Some would say we never knew.
I'm still recovering from the hangover from the fucking Christmas episode.
So is the Hamiltron, I believe.
I think she's absent today. Chucked her sickie.
But after our Christmas special, which was just you and I, James, Mr. Todd was mysteriously absent. We're now back to the full crew. We're no longer the skeleton crew that the skeleton of sobriety, as Slayer once sang about. Fragments of what used to be skeleton of sobriety. That's a hip reference to a classic thrash metal album from 1990. Ask your parents, kids.
Is this an episode of Riff Sobriety?
Not yet. How are we, guys? We all good?
Pretty good.
We all ready to dive back into Mr. Robert?
Mr. Gobots?
Oh yeah, our listeners who may well have figured it out by either the episode title or by what we said at the start.
They're a clever bunch of our listeners, I imagine they probably have. Detectives, a lot of them.
Citizen detectives, a lot of them.
Citizen detectives, just like Christina Ricci. That's a hip reference to Yellow Jackets, but more on that later.
We're back in the Mr. Robot train, guys. We're back where it all began.
We're finally back. Going back into time to 2015.
Yeah, we are going to kick off today by talking about the two-part opener to Season 2, the much maligned, in some areas, by fucking morons, Season 2, because Season 2 is incredible. And I don't know about you guys. Well, I know specifically about you, Craig, because we messaged each other about it.
Literally today.
I haven't watched these episodes for a while, so upon rewatching it, I was struck once again by, my God, I have had to spend the day liberally applying chapstick. Because I am going to suck Sam Esmail's dick so much in this episode.
Yeah, that's fair. I mean, we have spoken before on this podcast about just how fond we are of Season 2. And in fact, I think I mentioned before that when I first watched this show, I binged the first two seasons back to back because it was between Seasons 2 and 3 that I started watching it. And I remember with it, I mean, I loved the show right away, but when it got to the early episodes of Season 2, that's when it really became a thing for me where I was like, okay, this show is actually something truly special, not only in terms of the story it's telling, but in the form that it's telling it.
Look at the cast that comes in Season 2 as well.
Yeah, it's crazy. But it gets way more cinematic in this season, and Sam Esmail does, this is the first season we should say that Sam Esmail starts directing the entire thing, every single episode. And it was, each season was shot as though it was a giant movie, even though it's not written that way, because we will talk about this as well. I imagine that the episodes are very much written episodically. If we're going to make the Twin Peaks The Return comparison, Twin Peaks The Return was written like a movie as well as shot like a movie, whereas I think Mr. Robot from here on in is quite interesting that it was written episodically. But I'm just trying to imagine the sheer logistics, just how hellish that must have been to try and create something that you're shooting like a movie, but you're always having to keep in mind that you've got all these different chapters that are all self-contained in certain ways. Because one thing this show has always done, and we talked about it a lot when we were discussing the first season, is when you go back and watch this episode by episode as opposed to binging it, it really brings it home to you just how intricately structured each of these episodes are as their own self-contained part of the story. Like, there's a lot of symmetry within each episode. There's, like, you know, callbacks at the ends of episode to what happened at the beginning of the episode. It's really quite beautifully structured that way, and that's something that I do think when you're binging the show, you kind of miss a wee bit, because you end up forgetting where exactly certain things happened in the story, because you're absolutely embroiled in just that endless torrent of receiving it as one continuous narrative. For example, I did notice when I was watching part two of this season two premiere, we literally get two scenes of Dom, introduction of Dom this season, and we get two scenes with her. They're both really short and they both tell us next to nothing. And I did not pick up on that the first time I watched this show, because of course I immediately went on to watch the third and the fourth and the fifth episode. So yep. It just seemed to me that I received all of Dom quite quickly. But when you're watching it episode to episode, just those quick, we get Dom in the shop picking up her turkey sandwich, and then we get Dom very, very briefly at the FBI headquarters, and that's it. And there's no context even for what she's doing at FBI headquarters. And so watching that week to week, if you just watch that one episode on its own, those two episodes on their own together, you come away going, who the fuck was that person? Why was that scene in there?
I believe we talked about this before as well. Season two was the point I started watching it week to week, because me and Sarah had watched season one just before the start of season two, and I can relate, because like we watched the first couple episodes and I was like, who are all these people? This is a completely different gang now. Mm-hmm. And I don't know who they are. And then when you rewatch it, it just seems like, oh yes, it's completely natural that they're all being introduced like this, but the way these characters are just kind of like dripped in is,
yes,
chef's kiss, man.
In our defense of season two previously, and I hate even phrasing it like that, because for me season two does not need to be defended, because it's demonstrably fucking great.
I was fucking shocked when you said that folk were not a fan of it, like totally blown away when you said that.
If you go onto the Mr. Robot subreddit, like every second post is some Aye. Fucking idiot saying, oh, I don't like season two, should I keep watching? Like,
it's no exaggeration to say as well that every single podcast out there that covered this show all said the same thing. And when I went back to listen to podcasts covering it, even a lot of podcasts I like, I'm like, I don't understand what you guys are fucking talking about, because this season is amazing. I think the only reason people lose the sense that they had in season one is that narratively this is, where Elliot's concerned, things do stall a wee bit in terms of he's no longer the proactive protagonist for at least the first half of the season. But that's exactly the point of the story. I mean, and I've said this as well before on podcasts, but Mr. Robot is structured to me like what a long novel in TV form. And quite often epic novels are split up into three or four books, you know. And this, when you get to in a narrative like this, it is quite natural. It seems totally natural to me that the second part of the story should all be all about the protagonist's dissolution. And disillusionment from everything they were doing in the first part. It's almost like writing 101.
Yeah, it's the hero's journey.
Right, but I think the difference is Sam Esmail treats this, I think quite often, particularly in television and in movies as well a lot of the time, is that part of the story is always treated as if it's not as important as the other parts, whereas Sam Esmail really goes out of his way to spend time in this part of the story. It's literally the entirety of this season. And for him, this is absolutely every bit as important a part of the story as every other part. And I really appreciated that on the first viewing, and I appreciate it every time I rewatch it. I love really sinking into the atmosphere and the rich detail of the world that he creates throughout the entire show. you could not have the story of Mr. Robot without this season. I mean, the people who don't like the season, I want to hear their suggestions about what they do instead. You know what I mean? because I don't see any other way you can tell this story.
I'll tell you what those people want. Those people want four seasons of season one repeated. They want Hack of the Week. They want right. Leverage Redemption, which to be fair is quite good. But
I would watch that show. Like, but also, I forgot Joey Badass.
Yeah, when I first watched this show, I had no idea he was in this. And I remember the first time he appeared on screen, I squeed so hard. I was like, holy shit.
The first thing he does on screen is start moaning about Seinfeld. It's
so good. He shows about nothing. They don't even eat at the end of the episode.
On that note, shall we dive into it then?
Let's talk about Mr. Robot, Season 2, Episode 1, Unmask.tc, Part 1.
So we start off with a flashback to the night of the 5-9 hack. And I remember talking about this as we'd wrapped up our season one, because I went back and looked at this just to see, just to map exactly where Terrell and Mastermind Elliot were at this time. But just to refresh our memories, this is definitely a detail I missed the first time I ever watched the show, because I wasn't really listening to what Terrell was saying on the phone. But it's a tech called James, who's always been cool, I think, phones him up and is basically telling him about the honeypot that Gideon has set up. And Terrell is saying to him, it has to come down right now. And basically he pulls rank on Gideon. And so this tech is left going, well, I guess I have to do what he says. But we learn later that James and tech realizes this is highly suspicious. And that's why we end up where we end up later. This whole scene is so cool. All of the scenes in Fun Society are always great, because that location is amazing. And the way it's lit with that kind of slightly sickly kind of greenish yellow light, it just feels nice and grimy, but also slightly surreal at the same time. It's just such a beautiful location.
Cyberpunk as fuck.
Yeah, it really is.
Terrell asks Elliot, why the mask? It's kind of silly. And of course, the whole concept of the mask is going to be the main theme, as the title suggests, of these two episodes. But I also like that moment, because it kind of, it's another moment where you realise that there is that gulf between Terrell and Elliot in terms of Terrell's understanding of what Elliot is. Because he's in a moment here thinking he understands Elliot. And when we finally get to season three, where we have another rerun of this scene and we find out what happens afterwards when Irving turns up, you see Terrell at that point really realise just how out of his depth he is in that moment. And we have that great moment of Terrell turning into the wee boy version of himself, which we always love.
Actually, funny you mention that, because there's a moment in part one and a moment in part two. Actually, maybe two moments in part two, actually. But in these two episodes where characters suddenly realise they're completely out of their depth. And Terrell makes three. It's just you don't see that happen properly till later on in the series. It's the moment that Scott Knowles is watching the money burn. The moment where he realizes that he has nothing to bargain with F-Society, because everything he believes or that he thinks he can bargain with is burning in front of him.
And then
there's that moment later when Elliot / Mastermind is just having a laugh. He's having a totally normal one.
A totally normal one.
Mr. Robot realizes he's powerless at that point. He's getting the same thing. He's got nothing left that he can actually bargain with Elliot.
We see Elliot completing the code and the final communications with the Dark Army.
Spirit away, the 9th of May. The last communication from the Dark Army.
And then we get Elliot edging towards the Chekhov's popcorn gun that we know is hiding in there. But I really love Terrell's line at the end of the scene, where he says it's almost as if something's come alive when he sees the code being activated. This always reminds me of, now I'm going to mention a filmmaker who I generally malign quite a lot, but did make one good movie at the start of his career.
Yuri Ball.
Close. Darren Aronofsky.
Turtle Power.
Did either of you ever see his movie Pie?
It was fucking years ago, but
it's a good movie. I actually like that movie, and I think it's a good example of a film where the content really marries well with the form. Like what Aronofsky did visually and in terms of editing with that movie, where it's, the whole theme is that the stock market is a living creature, and the main character is so obsessed with it that there's this sense that mathematics is an organism and it begins to inhabit the organism of the lead character, who then becomes mathematics. And it's one of those really wanky ideas that when you say it out loud, it's like, that's not a movie, son.
And it's black and white, which is extra wanky.
But it's also set in New York, and it's like the late 90s, and it's very, very atmospheric, very moody, and it's got a real Mr. Robot theme. It's got a real kind of Mr. Robot vibe about it.
Is it in French?
It's not French, Alan, sadly.
But this also says, because obviously the protagonist of that movie is in front of a computer for about 50% of the movie. It does have major Mr. Robot vibes.
At any point in hacker voice, does he say, I'm in?
He does not have that cliche.
Wasted.
But Aronofsky would then go on to make such movies as Mother, which is a thing, an abomination. I am never going to forgive that man for making me sit through.
I've never seen that.
No.
It's one of the few films I've ever heard about where the reviews have genuinely put me off watching it.
Fuck, I mean, Jesus Christ, man.
Usually, if a movie gets panned, I'm like, fuck yeah, I want to see that, you know, but nope. I thought Requiem for a Dream was good.
It's okay. Yeah. It's actually okay, yeah.
Just didn't like the ending.
The Wrestler's not a bad movie as well. I think when he reins himself in a wee bit, he's fine. But the worst thing about Mother, and it's the worst thing about... When Aronofsky is at his worst, it's like when he takes ideas that a film student would have and tries to make them into series art movies. You're like, mate, fuck up.
Did Dan Aronofsky make that fucking Noah's Ark movie with the rock monsters and shit?
So Mother is not even his first Christian allegory. It's like, mate, give it up.
Is that the one with Russell Crowe?
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, that looked awful, man.
Anyway, he can fucking go Darren Aronofsky out of this podcast.
It's a hip reference to Scottish dialect.
From Chekhov's popcorn gun, we have a literal smash cut.
Literal smash cut to young Elliot falling out the window. Which we later come to learn is young Elliot jumping out the window. Rewatching this now with the full knowledge of where this story goes is really interesting, revisiting these scenes. After he falls, after he comes down, and you hear Edward and Magda shouting, Edward is clearly really distraught, which on the one hand throws us off the scent that Edward had anything to do with this. And also now, you know, looking at it again, we're like, well, no, of course, in this moment, he is innocent, quote-unquote innocent, because he did not push Elliot out the window. So, of course, he's 100% believable here, because he absolutely did not push Elliot out the window. The other thing I love about the dialogue in the background, though, is Magda saying, she has this great line, when Edward says it was an accident, Magda says, God says there are no accidents. I fucking love that line. Magda's one of my favourite characters in this whole show because she's so rarely used, but when Esmail decides to put her in, he also always gives her these really enigmatic moments. It's like she almost exists outside of the show and just sort of creeps in every now and again with some kind
she's
of...
She's like a ghost all the way through it.
With some kind of very weird esoteric metaphorical statement that... It does a dual job as well, because we start to learn from early in the show that things are not quite right with Magda. She's an unusual woman, I think we can agree, right?
We
also have our analysis about how she might feel about Edward and whether or not she knows what Edward is up to with Elliot, which we can discuss once we get to that hospital bit. The way she comes out with these things, part of where my brain always goes is she in the Sarah Palmer zone? Where she does have some knowledge, but as a result of that, she's developed some kind of psychosis, or mentally she's having some kind of, like in some kind of fugue state. Because if you do suspect something like that about your significant other, then how do you deal with it? I mean, you have to conceal it in your mind to some extent, or you would go to the police, or you would do something else.
Has she created an Elliot Alderson style loop?
Maybe. Yeah. Maybe this runs in the family. But yeah, that's after they then go at the hospital.
The way that she's talking to him when you first watch it, it's purely on a surface level. It's like he's lost his job, she thinks he's a fucking loser. But watching it now, having seen the whole thing, you're just watching it going, oh my God, this is absolutely horrifying. And Elliot's just sitting there like in another world, just completely blocking it all out. Yeah.
She is severe towards Edward in this moment, like severe, unforgiving. And the first time you see this, you're thinking, God, that woman is the worst. But now I'm like, I don't know.
You're watching it the first time around going, women, am I right? Can't live with them.
Take my wife, please.
Esmail never gives us a complete answer. as to what is going on with Magda, mentally and emotionally. He never ever tells us for sure, so we're left to interpret it. But more and more I watch it, the more I'm kind of coming around to the ideas that, no, she knows, even if she hasn't told Edward that she knows. Because of
she
that,
she at least suspects.
She at least suspects, and because of that, she's going to make Edward's life hell. But it's probably, I mean, inevitably it has to be, if that's the case, it has to be also motivated by self-loathing as well for not being able to protect her son. But then, of course, people will then say, but we see her be abusive as well. I guess I'm on the wagon over that, well, this has just caused such a mental split in her own mind. But we don't know for sure, because she could have been an abuser right from the start. Esmail doesn't tell us, so we just have to, I don't know, we have to come up with our own
explanation. The way that Elliot and Darlene talk about her.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
Gives the impression that she wasn't exactly an
mother of the year.
Yeah. The stuff in this scene that the doctor starts saying to Elliot is classic, are you being abused?
Yes,
stuff.
And that seems to be definitely where it's going.
And at the time, the first time seeing it, my assumption was the doctor's asking him about, you know, oh, did he push you out the window? Upon this view, and I'm like, this sounds like the doctor is literally concerned for him being abused. Yeah. And as soon as it gets to there, that's the doctor's voice starts to
It goes on the Charlie Brown's teacher voice. But the interesting way about it, the way Esmail puts that together is with the camera drip. For the main part of the scene, while Edward and Magda are still in the room, we don't see their faces and we don't see the doctor's face. We're purely with Elliot in that moment because he's purely inside himself. And it's a really interesting directorial decision that Esmail makes there. We don't see the doctor as soon as the parents leave the room. And it's like, because that's Elliot now can look at the doctor because, you know, it's that sort of being a bit inhibited at the idea that maybe I should say something. There's some kind of awareness. Can I do that? And then the way that Esmail chooses to drift the camera over to the brain scans, so obviously symbolically diving into where this other part of Elliot lives, who now obviously comes to the fore and says, no, there was no abuse, you know?
Yeah.
And so just erases it from his consciousness. And it's that kind of thing you don't see the first time, but you look at it now and you're like, That's great shit. It's great filmmaking.
Especially with the needle drop at that point as well, when Daydream kicks in.
Yeah.
Yes, it's quality.
So it's another good classic Mr. Robot needle drop.
And straight from Daydream into the first shot of the red wheelbarrow notebook.
Inside a Daydream. Elliot currently, take another drink for another Twin Peaks reference, but Elliot living inside a dream.
Yep, as Philip Jeffries would say.
That notebook, which I believe you own as well, Craig, right?
I do. So for anybody who doesn't know this, there is actually a real version of that book that you can buy, Elliot's Journal, and it is written by Sam Esmail and one of the other, I think it's, is it Courtney Looney, the other writer who co-wrote it with him?
I think so, yeah.
It's great. It's so good.
Mr. Robot, Red Wheelbarrow, episode 1.91_redwheelbarrow.txt.
There you go. But the book is great. It's put together like an actual journal, and it looks so genuine. And it's got things in it as well. It's got objects like envelopes from it, and it's got like a letter from Darlene, and it's incredible the work they put into that. That, for me, is maybe my favourite ever tie-in product of any TV show or movie or anything. It maybe supersedes, in my opinion, The Secret Diary of Laura Palmer from back in the day, but it certainly, it performs a similar function in that it allows the reader slash viewer into the world to try and be a detective about the show. And what's really interesting when you read it, after watching the whole series, when you go back and read some of that stuff now, there's so many enigmas in it that you start to, because you know the conclusion, there are things in it where maybe it wasn't Sam Esmail coming out and making direct reference to some of the things we learned in season 4, but you start to interpret it that way, and it's written that way where you're free to do that. But there's so many things in it that do come to fruition throughout season 2, and it was a bold move to bring that book out as a companion to season 2, because there are definitely clues in there, and we'll talk in a moment about the visual clues and the thing we should have fucking figured out the first time we watched this. But there's way more clues in the book itself that do make it a bit more obvious, but only if you're looking for it, I guess. Alright, so let's just talk about that. So the first thing we get is Magda opening a mysteriously sliding door, like who the fuck has that in their bedroom outside of Japan, and telling Elliot, it's time to get up. And I don't know why back in 2017 when I watched this for the first time that I did not have any questions about that. I should have had questions.
It's so obviously.
And the fact that he keeps on meeting Leon in the same place for breakfast, lunch, and
exactly the same time.
Yeah.
Watching the basketball game.
Yeah.
Everything about it's so freaking obvious now.
It's the beauty of the way this is written, though. It's and shot. Like, again, we are going to fillet the hell out of Sam Esmail. If you've listened to our Mr. Robot stuff before, you'll know this isn't a both sides critical podcast where it comes to Mr. Robot.
We're pretty gushing in our praise of this show.
And the way he constructs it is so clever that on first watch, it does genuinely just seem you're totally sucked in to this loop that Elliot's made and you're convinced that it's real.
Right, I think the other thing as well is, I know where I was mentally at the time, having just come off the first season and really getting into the groove of, all right, so I don't necessarily know that I can trust anything that Elliot tells me. So for that reason, I wasn't necessarily looking out for for hidden, obvious fucking things like, hey, he's actually in prison, guys, duh. What I was looking for was, I guess I was more just getting off on the fact that everything in the show now just seemed that bit more heightened and that bit more hyper-real, which when you're watching these scenes with that in mind, you just take it at face value. For me, anyway, I took it at face value that I'm sure Magda's house does not look like this, but this is how Elliot's perceiving it. And hey, I wasn't wrong. I was just wrong about it being Magda's house.
Magda's big house.
Magda's big house.
We're told from the get-go that Elliot doesn't trust us, so of course he's going to hide the truth from us.
Yeah. Aye, exactly.
It's right there.
Forget an unreliable narrator, you've got an unreliable audience as far as he's concerned. Like,
yeah. I mean, there were people at the time, like on Reddit and elsewhere, who did correctly guess what was happening here. So not everybody was as dumb as we are. But I was completely swayed over. Oh well.
The episode where it's like revealed where he actually is, I was like, what? Like, how the fuck did you not see it?
I think I'd started to figure out just maybe the episode before that. So when it happened, I was like, yeah, right, okay, I'm a fucking idiot. All right, Esmail, rub it in.
Obviously, one of us is the dumbest. Do you know what I mean? Like, there's never been any question about that. But
it's like the first time you watch season one and it's like, oh, wait a minute, he is Mr. Robot. Right. Fuck, it's so obvious the second time you watch it.
Well, I mean, I had the same experience with that. Like, I figured it out at the start of that episode. So that whole episode, I was like, oh, well, I'm just waiting for him to turn around and say. But at the same time, it was that way where I was like, Maybe Sam Esmail wants me to think that and something else is going to happen. So when the reveal, quote-unquote, came, I was like, all right, so it was that, fuck's sake, this fucking show.
The program was described to me as like a hacker version of Fight Club, so it was always in my mind that it was the same person. So
I guess that does give it away.
So fuck the person who said it's like a hacker Fight Club, dickhead. Cheers.
But Elliot goes on to tell us every day is a loop, perfectly constructed, which that is what a prisoner's life is like, I guess. But the other thing it's doing is it's also drawing us back to the idea of kind of what I mentioned earlier with the pie comparison, that Elliot lives in a world where he's almost like a computer himself. And, you know, that's the way I was receiving this stuff the first time I watched it. It's like, all right, Elliot's a computer guy now, literally a computer guy. And he's just talking about being on a loop. I get it. I didn't get it.
And in hindsight, again, it's also shown us for a fact that the mastermind is capable of creating these loops of self-deception. They're essentially creating like alternate realities inside his head.
Yes.
So when you come to the,
it's fully prepping us for the big reveal in season four.
Yeah. It's so good. I love this show.
But yeah, this is where we meet the great Joey Badass is Leon, and his regular meets at the quote unquote diner.
Kramer dude, I'd knock his ass
out. Knock Kramer's ass out. I do really love the meta stuff here that Sam Esmail throws in with Leon's commentary about Seinfeld and getting us to question what we're watching in Mr. Robot, with Leon saying stuff like, well, that's not a TV show. Where's the story? Makes no sense. That's literally all the guys on Reddit talking about season two of Mr. Robot.
Let's take a moment to praise Joey Badass.
He's so great. I squeed when he first appeared because I was a big fan of his music and a big fan of him as a human being. He's always seemed like a great guy, a very conscious MC, and just seems like he's got a good head on his shoulders. He says a lot of great stuff. As an artist, he's aesthetically great as well. And if you're one of those people you think you don't like, quote unquote, the modern rap, then I think Joey Badass is one of those artists that managed to straddle the golden era of hip hop from the 90s, but make, you know, it's wrapped in enough contemporary aesthetics that it seems a contemporary, I guess, yeah. is the word. But it's nuts how great he is in this role. I mean,
maybe my favourite character in a TV show full of great characters. Like, it's like between him and
Irving, yeah.
Considering what he does, that like the shit he does, he seems like the sort of character you should end up hating by the end of it.
Yeah,
but you still
but
don't,
hard,
despite
yeah.
the bad shit he does.
Yeah, yeah.
Joey Goodass, am I right?
Nice. This is a character that leaps off the screen as well. Like yeah. as soon as he appears, it's like, okay, I get this guy. And even though, of course, he does reveal new things as we go on, you kind of the danger of Leon, I think, is communicated to us very subtly immediately. You do get the sense that, well, Elliot better be careful around this guy. He seems like he might be a bit dangerous. But he's also so fucking funny. Like, everything he says in those first few scenes, it's like, okay, we're 5 minutes into this and this guy's just spouted out some of the best lines that show has ever had. This is going to be a good season. And it is a good season, guys.
Yeah, it's one of the best seasons.
This is definitely one of the four best seasons of Mr. Robot. Yeah.
He is Sisterhood of Dada level, newly introduced character becomes instantly beloved, frankly.
Yeah.
That was a hip reference to Doom Patrol. Then we get the next obvious clue that Elliot is in prison because he's just sitting in a park watching a basketball
game. Yeah, right, and who does that? And why would Elliot do that?
In the same time, every day.
Furthermore, why is Hot Carla there?
Right, yes. And that should have told us something, eh? Hot Carla, the local pyro, because every neighbourhood's got one of those.
Yeah. Burning a copy of Waiting for Godot in a red wheelbarrow.
That's fabulous. Like,
it's so good. This is a Hot Carla stan account now, so.
No, absolutely, she's great.
Incredible. But yeah, I was doing a lot of pausing during these two episodes to see what things were, and I was, because I don't think I'd ever picked up on what book she was burning before.
No, same, like, until you said it there.
It's a good call, because there's a lot about this season, and part of the reason why I think some people don't like it, that actually is quite Beckett-esque. Particularly, I mean, there's a lot of scenes in this season that are two-handers in otherwise empty rooms, and it's got that sense of being like a Beckett play. Interestingly, Elliot does give us an explanation, quote-unquote, for why he watches the basketball.
Oh, yeah.
Which I guess Esmail felt he had to do because he knew that would be an immediate question we all have. Why is Elliot, of all people, watching basketball? And it's the whole thing about he doesn't understand the emotion of sport, doesn't understand why people get so excited about it.
Same
energy. But he likes the beauty and the invisible code of chaos behind the illusion of order, which goes back to all of the main themes of the first season. So it seems like it makes sense. So, you know, certainly the first time I watched it, when Elliot said that, I guess I just went, all right, fair enough. Whereas in reality, I should have been, but really every fucking day? Come on, man.
Yeah. But it's also kind of backed up by what Ray says later as well. He kind of says a similar thing when he's talking about what Maxine
That's true.
Sees when she looks at the game and stuff.
Yeah.
Maxine, star of the show.
Yeah, bestest doggo.
Look at that smile.
When he's done with basketball, he cleans the house again. That seems like something Elliot would do.
Classic Elliot, the character we've all known and love.
And then dinner with Leon, at dinner time, Leon tells him that Seinfeld is just saying to him that maybe shit is just pointless, and that's the show's point, that human condition is a tragedy. Thanks, Sam, we see what you're doing. But yeah, again, there's a quote-unquote explanation shoehorned in there in that same scene. Elliot tells us, it's fine because I never have to talk and the repetition is good for me. And it's like, again, I was like, sure, all right then.
Okay, we'll accept, we'll not question. Thank you, Mr. Esmail, continue to spoon feed me.
Another thing I really like about that whole sequence is in the background we get the speech from Obama, which nicely manipulated to insert the words Terrell Wellington F Society.
the parts specifically referencing fSociety are done by an Obama impersonator.
Is that right? There you go.
Yeah, and they and the footage is just cut up to make it look kind of like make the lip sync match up.
That's it's great work. But the stuff Obama is saying here is so good. Where he started about we'll respond at a time and a place of our choosing. And it's like, in the real world, there's no way he would say something like that in this situation. But it's that kind of thing that, in this show, it sort of works. Like, Esmail is doing everything he can to make us think, this is set in a world now where the entirety of the world order as we know about it realizes that it's in danger of collapsing.
The new world order.
It's in such a panic state right now that it has to say nothing at all but give the illusion of saying a thing.
Philip Price takes this subtext later and turns
yes,
it into text.
Yes, he does. Yeah. but it also, we'll respond at a time and place we choose. It also like, is mirroring what's going on inside Elliot because he's constantly afraid that Mr. Robot is going to come and strike at a time of his choosing. And Elliot's whole thing right now is to try and stave off Mr. Robot, trying to make sure that Mr. Robot does not regain control. Obama says, a new future is ready to be written, which... You have no idea how right you are, son.
Yeah, thanks, Obama.
But the other thing I like about that is it's kind of making reference to when these sort of things do happen in history, and you look through history, this happens all the time. In a country like the US, it certainly happens a lot. And again, Philip Price will make this writ large in the second part, is you sell an oncoming wave of increased oppression as increased freedom. And that's essentially what Obama is doing in this speech. He's buttering up the American people for precisely this kind of thing.
Call it freedom fries, whatever you want.
Right, exactly. Yeah, it's great shit. It's great writing. We also get the nugget about that Elliot attends a church group now and that these people seem normal.
Yeah, because of course he would do that. Is this court ordered? Oh, of course not. No.
Yeah, and other than that, he's just journaling and enjoying analog sleep. And his mom, quote-unquote, has no computer or internet, so that's all fine. And he's not remotely ever tempted to go check out an internet cafe or anything like that. Okay, cool. This seems like you would definitely have that kind of willpower. But my favourite thing about this whole thing is how it ends this sequence, where we go straight into Elliot's monologue, continues right into a dialogue with Krista. Mm-hmm. And I made a note here about the way Krista's office is shot in this scene. It does look different from how we saw it in season one. And of course, It is different because, spoiler, he's not really there.
He's in the jail.
But it looks way bigger than it used to be. The room is way wider. And it's got that kind of the way David Lynch shot Isabella Rossellini's apartment in Blue Velvet vibe about it. Like, it looks wider than any room in any house should be unless it's appearing in James Wan's Malignant.
And from the outside, it's a shed.
But it's another subtle way that Esmail was kind of saying to us, maybe everything's not quite as it seems here.
It's not quite as obvious as when Gideon comes to see him later, when it's like, this is a prison scene.
Yeah, that's... Fuck, yeah. That one is so obviously a prison. How did we miss this?
Yeah. I'd sit watching most of this episode going, fuck's sake, like, what were you thinking?
The line when Krista's like,
why your
mom?
Mother? Yeah. So yeah. She knows that Elliot is using his mother as a construct in this moment, which looking back now is really interesting. And Elliot even tells us later after this scene that, no, I'm not going to tell you everything that was said in that room. I don't trust you yet. And it's like, fucking hell, this was really good writing. This was really clever. Because it makes total sense. I imagine we'll talk a lot about this when we get into the later seasons, but it's really when you get to seasons 3 and 4 you realise just how much Elliot trusts Krista. And it's a real smack in the face now going to look at this again and going, all right, there's so much she did know all along, which does make it make all the more sense later when she's kind of figured out the things that Elliot is refusing to admit to himself. Elliot even has a line here, and it's an old cliche, where answering why he chose his mother, than the devil you don't. The devil you don't has to be, of course, Mr. Robot, but whose face is Mr. Robot wearing? Edwards. And of course, that is the devil he doesn't know, or is rather refusing to know, because he's refusing to admit what happened with his father.
Yeah, better the devil you acknowledge than the devil you don't
acknowledge. Right, exactly. And that's some clever shit. On the rewatch, that's just so... That stuff like that now is just so delicious when you see it in the light of, you know, everything we come to know at the end of the series. So we learn that Darlene comes by sometimes, but I guess she's busy. Wonder with what. And Elliot doesn't seem bothered about his old life because he can't trust himself there, because he's really saying he can't trust himself in the outside world, and he's quite happy to be in prison. And Krista tells him he has to be more open, and that was part of the agreement, and we realise now that the agreement is she'll come and visit him in jail. And then he gets more honest, says, well, it's not that I don't trust myself, it's that I don't trust Mr. Robot. Yeah, and he tells us he's angry with us because we kept things from him. Which I do enjoy. Sorry, I always enjoy that meta moment. And then gets back to the bedroom, and Mr. Robot, talking to your friend again.
Sitting on the bed, reading Penthouse.
Yes. You would make a friend in there.
There's some nice friends in there for you.
And so this is the start of a new, really antagonistic phase of Mr. Robot, and he is the antagonist for this season, really. And I think this is something that a lot of people did not take to when they first saw this season. I think that's part of what made this a bitter pill in some ways. I think some people just found it a bit frustrating that why are we back at a point where it seemed like they understood each other last season? Why did they suddenly not understand each other? In the context of where the show goes, it makes complete sense. Then we've discussed it before, James, in our season one chat, about the whole point of Mr. Robot doing this is deliberately trying to goad the mastermind to fulfill its purpose so that it will eventually just disappear.
Yeah, he's pissed because the mastermind won't leave. All of this is just try and make the mastermind do what the mastermind needs to do to fuck off.
And Mr. Robot's whole plan seems to hinge on the idea that if I get the mastermind to fulfill the mastermind's ultimate purpose, then ultimately there'll be no more mastermind.
That superhero thing that Elliot was always dreaming of, he needs to get him to do that, the big takedown.
Yep, make it happen and it'll all be done, that's it. But I love how menacing Christian Slater is in this season, and in these early scenes... It's classic Slater. This is Slater from the early 90s, and I love it. I'm absolutely here for it.
Full Jack Nicholson, Christian Slater.
Full on Heathers.
Yes, yeah. He's channeling a lot of the Heathers. A revolution needs a leader. That's the great line that you said, Alan, about Guevara's thrown up in his grave right now. And I am not to be gotten rid of, and control is an illusion. There's so many great sound bites from Mr. Robot in this moment, and Elliot persevering to write it all down is such a great moment.
Do you imagine how much fun must it be to write those lines, and how much fun must it be for Christian Slater when he's just reading it going, okay, so this is when I get to completely go off the fucking deep end and just chew the scenery, and I'm surprised there's any of that bedroom left.
It's big enough. Slater's clearly relishing every moment of this as well, which I think is part of what makes these scenes so fun to watch. Elliot demands to know where Terrell is. Now, in the context of the whole series, Mr. Robot's not entirely sure where Terrell is, but he does at least know that he was taken away by Irving. But he's telling Elliot none of this right now. But when he says, I can't tell you that, he's not really lying, because he doesn't actually know where Irving took Terrell. And as we get this whole thing about Mr. Robot shooting Elliot in the face, which gets no less disturbing every time I see it.
But it's not the most disturbing gunshot in these two episodes, let's be real.
Well, that's true. All right, meanwhile... Let's catch up with our old pals in fSociety. What are they up to, guys? Oh, they're castrating the Wall Street bull, as you do. absolutely love the symbolism of this, and I just love how fun and cheeky it is. And that it's done with a piece of Matt Quayle's score that's so subtle and evocative that makes it seem as serious as possible. Yet the visual of it is just so ludicrous. And the metaphor is so unsubtle. It's just that marriage of subtle on the one hand and ludicrous on the other, and it's just a great sandwich of content, and it's the kind of thing this show just serves up beautifully a lot of the time. But where are fSociety going, guys? They are, in the immortal words of a hit from Eels in the 90s, going over to Susan's house.
That house is a fucking nightmare.
Susan Jacobs' smart house of horrors. Like, this is everything that you would worry about having a smart house. Like,
yeah.
And it's such a beautiful house. Like, that pool's amazing. Yeah. But...
I made a note here that Sam Esmail could have made a whole movie out of this, just Susan Jacobs being terrorised by the contents of her smart home. And it reminded me of like a short story that Brian Aldiss or Michael Moorcock would have written in the 60s or 70s. Yes. And if Sam Esmail wanted to make a movie of that, I'd be fine with it. Although I think these days, if somebody was going to make that movie now, I think who I want to make it is Julia De Corno.
Oh, yeah.
and she would make a story wherein eventually the homeowner ends up with Stockholm Syndrome and falls in love with the house.
Becomes pregnant, becomes pregnant to the house. Did you see it happen? Then it happened.
And I would be all about that movie. And it'd be like the reverse of a home invasion movie where the occupier is invaded by the house. I would be all about that.
And, you know, Sandrine Holt, who plays Susan Jacobs, mm-hmm. could be in that film because she is fluent in French.
Oh, there you go.
The marriage of Figaro has never sounded more terrifying than when it constantly keeps coming on.
It is truly terrifying. Sam Esmail gets very few horror movie moments in this show, but this is one of the best ones. And the fact that it's got that sort of sci-fi edge to it, yeah, I love all that. I'd gladly watch a whole movie of this. It's great shit.
The digital Amityville horror vibe.
I love when she freaks out and leaves and just everything stops in the house. It's
yeah,
like...
it's perfect. It's just a perfect, perfect beat. And then the doors barely even close when F-Society pile in. It's just so well put together. Yeah, and so Darlene muses that Susan Jacobs will probably stay away long enough. That's all that matters. And I've just written here, season two Darlene is best Darlene.
The scene where she's standing on the
balcony,
sort of balcony bit of the house.
Yeah, it's great.
It sort of echoes Philip Price in season one, standing on the balcony.
Yeah.
It's like a war movie, and you've got these two opposing sides. And
the first time we see her as well, from this moment on, she's wearing this jacket, which is my favourite piece of costume in this season. But it's like almost like a sort of revolutionary soldier's military jacket. It's just a perfect choice. It looks so great. And it just gives off all the right vibes, all the right aesthetic. It's such a great choice. She almost seems like a different character when we first see her in this scene. It's like, whoa, Darlene's gone really cold and hard. But of course, the next scene we see her in, she's having a panic attack. And it's like, all right, okay.
Stellar Darlene.
That's her mask. I see what you're doing with the title now. Meanwhile, we get the CIA director on the news citing this as a cyber Pearl Harbor.
Which sounds ludicrous, but in light of recent events when stuff is compared to Pearl Harbor all the time in American news now.
Yes, right, exactly. Yeah. But again, this is a really astute piece of... putting this in here as an aside is really astute stuff, because this is exactly what the CIA does in every one of these situations. I mean, the whole US military industrial complex will, you know, batten down whenever something like this happens. A, to, you know, reconstitute the illusion of them having control, but B, also give themselves as much opportunity as possible to expand whatever draconian measures they can, because they realize this is the perfect opportunity to do it. And it also gives them a chance to create new enemies. Because, yes, there may well be a real enemy, but you're now in a position where as long as you make someone look a certain way and you talk about people a certain way and you say it often enough, the American public will start to believe that their next-door neighbour is the enemy for, you know, reasons that are just complete bullshit.
You hold up this thing that happened to America and you say, but because of this...
These people let this happen. People like this let this happen. And it's also vague enough that certain... elements of the public can interpret it in their own way, you know, and you know, that's just what happens. And you can be sure as well that the CIA at this point will be having discussions with the rest of the military industrial complex and with Obama, saying well, you know, this is the perfect moment to start pointing fingers at China, which of course there's a real reason to do that in Mr. Robot. And it's also a good time to start pointing the fingers at Iran. It's also a good time to start pointing at North Korea. It's also a good time to start pointing the finger at Cuba. We can do it all right now because the internet exists everywhere, you know. So it's a golden opportunity to just double down on all that Cold War Volume 2 paranoia.
There's so much of that in these couple episodes as well from, like, commentators, which I meant to say we skipped over Let's Be Frank with Frank Cody.
So we did, yeah.
Shout out to Eric Jensen, by the way.
Oh, yes, your new pal on Instagram.
My new pal on Instagram started following me on Instagram because he liked a picture of...
Is that ramen noodles?
Yeah.
Ramen Malek, more like.
Eric Jensen has a D&D podcast.
Oh, really?
That's why he's following you.
Yeah, so I was like, oh, that's why he follows me. But I was just like, fucking Let's Be Frank followed me, and he was like, thanks for the shout out. So friend of the show, shout out to him.
First of all, gay. Second of all, stupid.
Not only is he amazing in the role of Frank Cody, and like the basically Mr. Robot Universe's version of Alex Jones,
yep.
He plays dual roles in this episode. He plays the F-Society guy who's holding the bull's balls and taking the selfie.
Oh, no way. Wow.
Yeah. I've not noticed that.
He's just got a big fake beard and a cap on.
Oh, he did a Windham Earl. Just popped into whatever the New York version of Tam Shepard's is. And Tam Shepard's.
Where were we?
Gideon visits...
having a totally normal one.
Gideon visits Magda's big house. Well, Mr. Robot is peeling an apple in probably the most sinister apple peeling ever committed to screen.
Yeah.
It's the most villain trope thing I've ever seen.
It's fucking nonsense. It reminded me of this. I seen in, I think it's season one of Dark, where, what's it, Noah is sitting peeled doing the same thing.
Yeah.
Yes, I. Yeah.
And it's a trope that gets pulled out now and again, but it takes a special gift to make it work, I think, and not make it look ridiculous. But I totally accept this is what Mr. Robot does.
It's totally lampshaded in Mr. Robot, like who's the bad guy here?
Yeah.
Like, well, we know it's not Mr. Robot, technically, but we only know that because we've seen the rest
of
the
season. Right, exactly, aye. For all intents and purposes right now, for the uninitiated watching season two the first time, Mr. Robot is the big bad here. But Gideon, not having a normal one, not having a good time. Down and out, Gideon is a sad, sad sight. There is no all safe. That's what we learn here. All safe is dunzo, Washington.
He had to furlough everyone.
Yeah, before it was cool.
2020, 2021, yeah.
Gideon, such a hipster, furloughing before it was cool.
He's a trendsetter.
Yeah, so Mr. Robot in Elliot's ear here saying, whose fault's this, that this happened? Can't recall. This is great shit. I love Christian Slater's delivery of all this stuff. He's just leaning into the, like you said earlier, the Heather Slater. Yeah. If it was me, it was you, kiddo.
That's where you're wrong, kiddo.
So the FBI believe that Gideon was complicit, and Gideon now knows that someone's been hacking his email. There's all these logins that he can't account for.
He thinks it's the feds, but we know.
Yeah, we know.
Mr. Robot's just like, it's amazing.
Yeah, tell him you're descending into madness, kiddo.
Pure panto villain shit.
It really is. And but Christian Slater can sell panto villain as being something compelling.
There's a line here where quote-unquote Elliot, I'm just going to keep calling him Elliot for the moment, where Elliot talks about Mr. Robot, and he says, once he's gone, I can finally be the real me. And it's like, oh, the
yeah,
irony.
That's a great line. In retrospect, that's a great line. But yeah, Mr. Robot really twisting the knife, and you're going to let him take the fall for this? And then describing Gideon as a small animal pretending to be bigger and scarier than he is. All that shit's great. I mean, Gideon is so pathetic in this scene.
I like when he gets a bit wide and Magda's like, what's going on there?
Yes. Guard Magda.
What the fuck? As if Gideon's going to be like, sorry, didn't mean to annoy your mum.
Sorry, Mrs. Alderson. I'll take my ball and leave now.
My full-grown adult ass is apologising.
Please don't tell my dad, Mrs. Alderson. How did we not have questions about this?
But the actress who plays Magda, whose name I always forget and I never take a note of it, help me out here. Yeah.
The actress's name is Vaishnavi Sharma.
Vaishnavi Sharma is just fucking brilliant, man. There's just the little things she does. It's like the kind of looks and the short phrases. That's all her dialogue is so good, man.
She has a glare that is so formidable. It's like, okay, I'm not going to argue. Which, when you look at it from that perspective, maybe if I was Gideon in a state of shell shock as he is, I guess I wouldn't argue either. But at the same time, it's like the way he shits himself. Yeah, I should have had more questions about that. So Mr. Robot is doubling down to Elliot here that Gideon is going to sell you out. What are you going to do about it? And we get that the fake out of Mr. Robot slicing Gideon's throat, which we know is a fake out, but still, it's not pleasant to watch.
No, but a foreshadowing, though, for, you know.
That's true. The other question we should have had is when Elliot gets up to the table and leaves, why is that the end of the conversation?
Yeah.
What, Gideon can't just follow him up the stairs?
Gideon can't walk around the table?
Wait a minute, Elliot.
Curse you, this table is so wide.
You found my one weakness.
Tables.
I cannot circumnavigate chairs. And the apple skin, I like how it's a sort of spiral pattern, the way Mr. Robot leaves it on the table. That's also like a pie reference as well. I don't know why I'm going out my way to advertise Darren Aronofsky's 1997 movie Pie, but if you've not seen it, it's a good movie. So Elliot is scribbling away in his journal, reassuring us and himself that he's the one in control. And yeah, that's where you get that line, where he can be the real me again once he's gone. Oh, yep. Elliot, you fool. Spoiler, dude, you're not the real you.
How am I not me? Oh, it's a reference to I Heart Huckabees, if anyone was wondering.
Never seen it, but no. I know that BoJack Horseman's a big fan of the director.
But the director's a great guy. The director's a real sweetheart, apparently.
So back for tea with Leon, catching up on Leon's latest Seinfeld habits. Leon muses that maybe the show's just telling us that we just live in a cold, random universe. I love that you can get this deep about Seinfeld. Or more specifically, I love that Leon gets this deep about Seinfeld. Leon asks about the bandage, which is a fair play because we know that nothing has really befallen Elliot's dome. But Elliot's just going through the panto because apparently that matters to him.
It's all part of his regimen.
And then we get this guy at the other table who's like a pound shop William Burroughs impersonator.
yes.
Which instantly sets me on edge. I'm like, don't trust that guy. Don't call him the priest. That's a hip reference to a William Burroughs short story.
Sits down and he's just like, yo man, you want to buy some bug powder?
You've had that spit in your face. It's more and more hip references to William Burroughs, well known as being the most accessible writer you'll ever meet. Yeah, Mr. Robot has a line here as well, that I'm the organ vital to your existence, you do not want to hurt my feelings. Which, you know, in the scheme of things, is kind of right, because we later learn that the only reason that Elliot has kind of survived, in a way, is because Mr. Robot has been protecting him, or at least that's certainly the way Mr. Robot sees it when we get that explained to us in Season 4. So once again, it's a good example of Mr. Robot acting the hard ass, but again, nothing of what he's saying is untrue. The visual, though, of Mr. Robot sitting at the table with Elliot and Leon is fucking great.
There's a dinner party I'd like to attend.
And Elliot is begging us to have hope for him, that he'll be able to be his true self again, which so many layers of irony now when you watch this. And he's telling us this over the image of Darlene's panic attack, which I think is quite interesting. And it's another subtle way, which I think, when you take it at surface value, it does have the meaning of, well, Elliot's in a much weaker position here, just like Darlene is, because we're about to see that she's not, we're seeing right here she's not as strong as she's letting on. And Elliot's really maybe not accepting that he's not in as strong a position either. Again, great filmmaking, man, especially on the rewatch. He really, the rewards are so rich on the rewatch. All right, so we get the revolutionary party with fSociety, and what I've written down, the Bullock Bollock selfie.
Having a wee lick of the balls. Eric Denson is doing to those bulls' balls what we are doing to Sam Esmail this whole podcast. And this way we get this beautiful shot of Darlene up in the...
Yeah, first of all, she puts her jacket back on.
Really, veranda there, sorry, that was fucking Scottish.
Scottish is fucking out in the veranda, son. But she puts her jacket back. She has
out
to put
with
her...
this podcast now.
Hit the klaxon. She has to put her revolutionary jacket back on and dons her war paint lipstick and then goes out to preach to her subjects. Another Matt Quayle sting here as she's delivering this speech. It's a really rousing but subtle piano score in the background. Mm-hmm. Matt Quayle doing great work here, man. He's so good. Give him all the fucking Emmys. He is cruelly overlooked as a composer.
He is so fucking good. I normally associate Matt Quayle's scores with just being total electro bangers.
Yeah.
Or like weird noise stuff, but he does
the
piano
subtle
stuff
so
well.
So
as
great.
Well, like...
It adds so much texture to the scenes. I think my favourite one is in the Philip Price scene coming up in the second episode, which I'm going to mention that when I was watching that. After us, like, holy shit, that's such a great choice. So Darlene demands the phone that the selfie was taken on and destroys it. And begins to tell them, we're in a war, we're still on the losing side. We're on our knees with guns to our heads and they're picking us off. She goes on to explain the reason they picked this house. Susan Jacobs, general counsel at ECOR, or as she's also known, Madam Executioner. She can kill any lawsuit, particularly those that involve deaths caused by the company. These are the cowards we're dealing with. We've been in our knees too long. It's time to stand up. I love everything that Darlene is selling here.
big simping over here. Big simping for
First time I watched this show, I remember thinking to myself, this is the first time I've ever watched a kind of semi-mainstream US show that has said this sort of shit out loud with a character that's meant to be sympathetic, and I'm sitting here pumping my big communist fist going, yes, they finally made a show for me. Hollywood unwittingly perhaps put out a show for me.
On USA Network.
On the USA Network, how did that happen?
But I mean, of course, the speech she knows is bullshit.
Yeah, it's not about the speech, it's about what it causes them to do. And I do enjoy seeing her direct the troops here. Like, she is very matter-of-fact. I did make a note here, actually, at the when we get the previously on segment at the start of this episode, we do get that previous scene from season one that I remember we talked about, James, where Darlene actually has a line when they're at the end of the world party, where she says, it's not about what we're going to do tomorrow, it's about right now appreciating what we did. And I remember saying, well, that shows Darlene's short-sightedness, because the reason a lot of revolutions fail is because they don't plan enough ahead. And here we're seeing Darlene recognize her mistake.
It's a month later, right?
It's like, we're in early June.
1 month
now.
Later, we're seeing the price she paid for that. And
the Philip price she paid.
The Philip price is right.
Or in this case, the price is shite.
And the fact that she's not only having to reckon with that, but how it's completely changed her outlook on what they're doing, and it has made her far more militant.
Yes, yeah.
And I am here for it, as the kids say.
Now, Mobley, and I remember saying this when we discussed season one, Mobley out of fSociety, I feel, is a wee bit of a lib. Because he tells Darlene she sounds like George W. Bush, which he says, first of all, low.
Second of all,
stupid. But yeah, Mobley's one of those people who mistakes any sort of militancy with somehow being reactionary. I feel like that's the inference here with where Mobley is psychologically. Mm-hmm. But Darlene says, no, she recognises that the speech isn't really what the speech is about. It's more about getting them motivated. As long as they believe 100% the content of the speech, that's all that matters in this moment. And she's pretty much right. And in a weird way, she's doing exactly what Mr. Robot did in season one.
And she's doing exactly what Philip Price says later as well.
Right.
The con doesn't work without the confidence, you know.
That, guys, is called symmetry. Or is it, to use an overused title for comic book stories in the late 80s and early 90s, fearful symmetry. Was there a comic book series that did not use that title at some point in that era?
I don't think so. I'm pretty sure every second 2000 AD story in the 90s was called that.
Obviously, every other story in the magazine Tiger would have had this, probably, right?
Right, yes. Mobley, to his credit, does remind Darlene, we were more than slogans, we were more than just, you know, cheap protest mm-hmm. tactics. But Darlene it's interesting how on the ball she is here compared to where she was at the end of the world party, because she's very aware that this stuff looks superficial, but it's more about getting the fSociety larger crew motivated. I'm curious how many members, active members of fSociety there are now, because I don't think we get an answer to that question, but this room is pretty fucking full.
Yeah, it looks like there's at least 20, 30 people in that house.
Yeah.
Yep. But of course, we're missing some key members.
Right, yes, no Trenton yet, so we've yet to see where she is. Because this is a rewatch, we know where we're going to see Romero next, unfortunately.
Yep. Press F in advance.
You did warn them, this plan is shit. But Darlene says, but we're no better off. In fact, in some ways, it seems worse. We didn't finish them off. That's the problem. People supported us, and they have to know we haven't given up. So Darlene's very concerned simultaneously with doing things the right way to a conclusion, and at the same time, presenting an image to the people, to their supporters. So propaganda of the deed is still important. And I wrote down in my notes, hashtag Praxis. Darlene is 100% on the Praxis train, because these are the two fronts you need to worry about if you want a successful revolution. If you want to join mine, join our Patreon. We don't have one. Yeah. We might have
join our OnlyFans.
Only comrades.
Top mark.
So I made a very technical note that Darlene does our rootkit, because I know a lot about this stuff. I'm very, very tech head me. Very tech head me. That's a good sentence, Woodsy. That shows how well I understand this stuff.
I understand it about as much as the 90s film Hackers.
Right, yeah. Hollywood hacker bullshit, as Romero would say, press F. Mobley asks about Elliot. Darlene tells him, that's not important right now. Right now, the revolution is everything. It's like, goddamn. Harsh, but also yay.
Yeah.
In the next scene, we get a real illustration of just how shitty things are for the common everyday e-core customer who they can't even close their accounts. I do enjoy this actress's performance. It seems like such a naturalistic performance. So like, well, I'm gonna close my account and never doing business with you crooks again. It's just such a naturalistic delivery. Whoever that actress is, that's top. It's a top performance.
That scene is like the anti "It's a Wonderful Life," right? Well, we can't give you the money back because it's in his house. In his house. And...
it's a pure shite life.
Yeah.
I love because I love when it expands back to show the screens, but at the same time as it shows the screens, it also shows how many people are waiting.
Right,
in
bank. It's a really economical, effective storytelling, because from a storytelling standpoint, it just segues nicely into, oh, this is what Darlene was doing. and then I've got the person said, I've got the IT guy helping me, and of course it's Mobley, and it's like, nice.
Mobley's hilarious, confused IT guy face is amazing. Shrug. He just hits a couple of keys and shrugs.
It's amazing. I don't know. We try to turn it off and on again.
Fucking brilliant.
And then we get a three-hander, a Beckett moment in the panoramic corner suite here, which I love this location. This is such a great office location. The way it's like two floors, but the two floors are exposed, so there's like this whole part of this suite can see out to the entire city. So we're still in a place where these people are on top of the world. This is Price Knowles and Susan Jacobs. The way it's shot as well, it's so fucking good. Fuck me, man. Sam Esmail knows how to compose a shot in these kind of locations. It just looks... everything gleams in this scene. Yeah, it's incredible. In case you didn't already know, these are the coldest motherfuckers on the face of the planet. Everything is metallic and glass and gleaming in this scene.
Kind of blue.
Yeah, to quote Miles Davis.
I was going to say there, yeah.
It's a hip reference to a classic jazz album from 1959.
Is this an episode of F. Skronkite?
Now you must acquire a taste for freeform jazz.
So F Society are demanding $5.9 million tonight. The FBI will not sanction the payment. So Scott Knowles is resistant to this. He's saying they can fix the banking system in a matter of 5 days. And we've had so many moments like this in the first season where you really get that sense of just how small fry a lot of this shit is to the people at the upper echelons of capitalist power. But the way that Susan Jacob just writs it large here, it says that, well, we can't afford the optics. We can find the money between our couch cushions.
Yeah. It's pennies. And on the first view, I wondered why. I was like, okay, it's clearly symbolic. They want 5.9, right?
Yes, yeah.
But I was like, what are they going to do with that money?
Don't get it.
It's because what the thing is, Alan, right, what they're doing is they're rating their revolution out of 5s out of 9.
Yeah, just like they were inspired by this podcast.
Absolutely need to sue the shit out of fucking Sam Esmail. Yeah. Here, like,
are very easy to describe and explain scoring system. But F Society demand they send one of their chiefs, and I quite enjoy the way that Price just doesn't understand what that means. Like, who are the chiefs? It's like, I think they just mean one of our chief officers, and Price regards this as the most hilarious thing he's heard all week.
I love that, the lols. Price, a lot of the time he seems just like flabbergasted about what's going on, but a lot of the times he seems like he's just having a pure laugh.
He does.
He seems like he's having a great time. Because he still can't be touched, and he fucking knows
exactly.
It. He's like...
aye. And none of this is touching him yet. And he's fully confident at this moment that he's going to go to the government, as we see in the next episode, and he's going to own the room. So yeah, he feels he's in absolutely no danger here. And Michael Christopher doing such great work as always. That guy is so fucking good. I think we talked about this before, but you can tell this guy's a theater actor, because even when he's not meaning to project, he accidentally projects anyway.
He does.
But he's so fucking great because he's such a larger than life character naturally. So, and then when you put this dialogue in his mouth, and I know but I'll say it again. We did talk about it when we talked about the first season. But I remember one of the criticisms I saw some people say about this character was they felt they made him a wee bit too cartoonish. And it's like, I get that people at the top of massive corporations, obviously they're evil in the scheme of things, but do they really talk like this and shit? And I was like, I fully believe that these people do talk like this. And I've said this in the podcast before, but I think the era of the Trump presidency really let us all know, the mask fell at that point, that yes, these people really do fucking talk like that. That is exactly what they talk like. If anything, Michael Christopher's version of that is actually quite subtle by comparison.
I think the fact that Michael Christopher manages to still be likable through all of this shit.
Yeah, he's always an entertaining character to watch. Even if you think he's a complete piece of shit, he's engaging as a character.
Yeah, unlike the real life equivalents.
Well, that's true. Just, you know,
cunts to a man, but
cunts to a cunt.
Scott Knowles drops the hot T word. It's like, we don't negotiate with terrorists. It's like, all right, dude, what is this, 2004? Grow up.
All right, Reagan. And much like Reagan, he is going to then go and negotiate with terrorists.
Right, yes.
Well, in his heart, he thought that to be true. He now knows.
Nice reference.
Filmed, it is not. I'm glad
Reagan did. All three of these actors are superb. I actually like the chemistry they've got going here. There's also a danger when you've got somebody like Michael Christopher playing the character he's playing, that he will swallow up the room. But I feel like both Sandrine Holt and... who's the actor plays Scott Knowles? Brian Stokes Mitchell is the actor's name. But they're all great. I mean, they're doing such solid work in this moment. And it's three absolute pieces of shit. But again, they're interesting characters. And the way each of them... I mean, each of those characters is so different. They've all got a completely different energy. On the subject of sucking Sam Esmail's dick, amongst all the great cinematic stuff he does, he's also just a great director of actors. Like, he seems to have a really clear vision of what he wants all of these actors to bring to each of these characters. And a scene like this, with three characters that are not remotely sympathetic, you're nonetheless engaged with what they are saying, and they seem like interesting characters. Yeah, it's great shit. Anyway, let me just spit that last bit out. You're welcome, Sam.
To wipe your mouth, we'll carry on.
But Susan Jacobs thinks a security officer should deliver it, and Price says that they should give fSociety no reason to do any more damage. So Philip is... at least of the mind that as much as he's having a fun time here, he also recognises he's not underestimating the threat. He realises it has to be neutralised, but he just is very confident they can handle it the right way. And that's when Scott Knowles volunteers to do it. I'm Chief Technology Officer. Yeah, me, not Terrell Wellick. I made a note here, it's like, mate, Terrell's not in the room, you don't have to keep rubbing that in. Have I mentioned I'm Chief Technology Officer?
Do you know who's not Chief Technology Officer?
If I mentioned I'm Chief Technology Officer and I definitely still have a wife.
Nice. So he decides, he says, I want to be the one that faces them. Yeah, well, I see the whites of their eyes type deal.
Yeah. It's like, mate, you've got no chance.
Get ready to put a mask on, literally and figuratively, because you're about to have egg in your face, son.
Do you remember the KLF? Do you remember them? Yeah. Like, just...
And it's at that moment, it's like being at the matinee at the old Rialto Cinema when I was growing up in the 80s. Intermission time, guys. Go and get yourself a chalk ice for the wee woman with the tray there down the bottom. I'm showing my age here, isn't it? That's not a thing anymore. Hasn't been a thing for about the better part of 25 years. Maybe more,
no,
I don't know.
They still do it in the pavilion.
Do they really? Fucking right. They should bring that back. Bring back the chalk ice lady. All these robots stealing the chalk ice lady's jobs. That wraps up Season 2, Episode 1, Unmasked Part 1. I did get a real kick when I first saw the word intermission. When I first time I watched this, I was like, that's cool. Like, and I sort of wished they'd done that at the end of every episode. Just so when you're watching it on the binge, it gives you the encouragement to get up off your arse and maybe, even if it's just to pour yourself a drink, just get up off the couch for like 2 minutes, guys. It helps, I think.
Doing that kind of passive-aggressive Netflix thing. You still watching?
Aye.
Do you not have better shit to do?
Go circulate some blood around your bodies, guys. I feel like that's a friendlier and more productive way to do it than just Netflix's, are you still watching this shit, you sad sack?
DVT is a real thing, guys. Like, you know.
Yeah. I would score Mr. Robot Season 2, Episode 1. Unmasked Part 1. This might come as no surprise to both of you guys. 9 fives out of 9.
Set what? Faces to stunned. Well, James, in shock news that is going to cause President Obama to make a very concerned speech on C-SPAN, I am likewise scoring this episode 9 fives out of 9.
I can't believe I'm hearing this. Me personally, I'm just going to break the trend here and say I thought it was totally Joey Badass.
Nice guy.
$2 signs out of Joey Badass.
Since it's intermission time, shall we make our way to the bar and have a wee refreshment or two?
Let's. I think we should top up a tipple. Piffle paffle.
A piffle paffle. That's a heavy reference to Doom Patrol.
Whose round is it?
Alan's, I think.
I believe so.
Alan, you weren't here last time, so it's your round.
Yeah, me and Craig spent a fortune at Christmas when we were fucked. That's the
first fair, comrades.
As anyone who battled their way through all 5.5 hours of our Christmas special will attest.
All edited down 5.5 hours.
Yeah, the original was somewhere in the region of 7.
Brilliant. Alan's going to get the drinks in, and we'll be right back after these very important messages.
Peace!
Alright, what are we all drinking tonight, guys?
Oh, is it just like old times? Well, I'm drinking, I think it's Mons and Vaux.
It's like talking to Del Boy here. Mons to me, old son.
I think it's Mons and Vaux Malbec from southwest France. Vin de France, the homeland of Malbec.
That's not true.
Is that like Kibbe?
Bottle said it, and I believe it.
The entirety of South America disagrees. Well, I'm drinking since nobody asked.
What are you, Craig? What are you drinking this evening?
Just before Christmas, my sister gave me one of those big mixed bundles of beer. So every bottle a different beer.
Nice.
And so I've been making my way through those with mixed results, I will say. But right, most of them have been not bad. This one is called, not familiar with it at all, I don't know if you are, Wainwright the Golden Beer. And I like the confidence with which it proclaims the golden beer, meaning presumably there are no other golden beers. Gun yourself, Wainwright. I admire your confidence.
Wainwright, a golden beer doesn't have the same kind of ring.
It doesn't, that's true.
Wainwright, a golden shower.
But it's a nice crisp beer, it goes down nicely.
Nice. What's been the best of the bunch so far of your selection?
I'll be honest, none of them have been remarkable. They've all been okay. They've all
Are
been
any
okay.
Of them as good as slavery apologists.
I think
King's
you know the answer to that. Speaking of which, it's weird we've not heard back from them about that slogan. I keep waiting for that sponsorship and it never happens.
Baffles me, man.
The Hamilton says she would keep a watch for that and she's never gotten back to us about it. What happened?
Yep, I was absolutely confident that that was going to be the winner, but nothing.
Let's move on, shall we?
Anyway, Alan, yourself, I'm going to take a wild guess here because I know that you are training for a big fight coming up. Yes. That you're probably on the water.
I am on the water, but I also branched out. I was going to say Mexican thing, but I believe it's more like a kind of Tex-Mex thing. I don't think I'm pronouncing this properly, but Patsy Mex? I don't know if I'm...
Very good.
Yeah, yeah, nice.
Pepsi Mix, no sugar, so you know I'm allowed.
It's Pepsi for raised dog.
Yes, nice one. That's what keeps that beautiful smile. So while we're in intermission land, before we dive back into the world of Mr. Robot, is there any extracurricular business you want to attend
to? Just in case anyone's not familiar with what we do at Bar Break, we have a little chat about other things we might have seen or listened to.
A wee brief segue into other areas of the pop cultural landscape.
Although presumably if you're listening to this for Mr. Robot, you've listened to all of our Season 1 Mr. Robot episodes, so you really should know the drill by now, guys. Come on, fuck, sort it out. This is what we do.
This is what we do here in fSobriety, to quote a certain FBI agent from Twin Peaks Return.
If you're just joining us for the first time, though, welcome. Thanks for joining us. Hello, friend. Yeah, have you watched anything lately, Craig, that's sparked your interest?
Well, James, that's a fun question because I know that you know the answer. Wait, is this an episode of fSobriety TV, the podcast in which we discuss other things TV besides the main bit of TV that we are currently discussing in the main podcast?
You know something, Craig?
Could be.
I think it might be.
Cue the music. Hello and welcome to another thrilling edition of fSobriety TV, the podcast in which we talk TV, more TV than the other TV that we were talking about. James, in answer to your question, you know the answer to. Yes, because we have both been, I know, really, really digging a certain show called Yellow Jackets. On your Showtime, which obviously we both have. Obviously, we are both Showtime subscribers.
No, I mean, we've been watching it on Sky Atlantic, I think.
Oh, that's what I meant, obviously.
Yeah, definitely.
So for MD unfamiliar, most people have probably heard chat about this show, but in broad strokes, James, in the 90s... A high school girls' football. One of the worst things about this show is continually having to listen to Americans use the word soccer. It just makes me want to drill my own teeth out. So I'm just going to use the word football because that's what we say over here because it's the correct fucking word.
But the problem is, Craig, if you say that and you say a girls' American football team, you're going to then think it's American football.
An American high school girls' football team. Can't go wrong with that. Are on a plane. Plane crashes, they end up in the wilderness of Canada somewhere, and they have to survive there for a pretty long time. And then there's a present day update of the story running concurrently, where there's some kind of mystery about some possible blackmail relating to the information about what happened out in the wilderness. That's the broad strokes, but we'll get... I'm saving any details right now. The reason being... The next episode of our podcast is going to be a Yellow Jackets coverage episode. We're going to be reviewing the first season of that show because James and I have dug it so much, and I've already said to Alan just yesterday, in fact, that we were doing this. And so, Alan, I think you're on the train of giving it a binge before we do that so you can join us.
Indeed I am. This evening after this, I'm going to watch the first episode. Maybe the second. We'll see how it goes.
It's tremendous. This so early on in the year, I think it's definitely going to be in my top 10 at the end of the year.
I wholeheartedly predict that it will be very high up in my top, list of top TV of 2022.
It's from 2021 though, is it not?
Quiet!
Well, it started 2021.
It finishes 2022, so it still qualifies. Okay. Besides which, we're applying the same rule that we apply to everything else, which is if it didn't come out before we started recording our interview episode, then it's the following year, basically.
Yeah, we discussed this, that it's the tax year of interview reviews runs like November to November.
If James and I are nothing else, we are 100% very fiscally aware.
Which is why I didn't talk about The Witcher Season 2, which aired after we had recorded our end-of-year episode. And, oh boy, I loved it.
Yeah, same.
First of all, gay.
Like, I don't think we need to talk about it much, Alan, because we'll probably bring it up in future anyway, just for lols. Because, again, it might be on my end-of-year list as well. Again, already planning a year ahead.
Let's hope it's a quiet year.
Well, it's not, because I was actually looking at my list of TV shows that I'm interested in this year, and there's already 15 shows on it or something.
I think it's going to be stacked.
Yeah.
My favourite thing about The Witcher, specifically Season 2, is that the character Jaskier appears to be from a different TV show entirely. It's like, so The Witcher is just this sort of slightly goofy, but still pretty amazing, epic fantasy show. Sorry, Craig, I know you hate the term.
I understand what you mean.
And here's this guy from Hollywood.
Yeah, and comes fucking Nathan Barley.
Nathan Barley, really?
Fucking amazing. Not literally.
Not the character, aye. That would be good. That I would watch.
Yeah. But Joey Beatty, who plays Jaskier, just seems like he's just walked in off the set of Nathan Barley, and he just like turns the show upside down every time he appears in it. So good. I need to watch it again because it got real confusing towards the end, Alan. Did you understand everything that happened?
No.
Cool. Right, it's not just me.
I can't get enough of Baba Yaga or variations thereof on screen, like a house with chicken legs or basilisk legs, as they refer to it in that. It's just fucking beautiful to me. I fucking love it.
This is a total segue here, and I'll make it brief, but you mentioning that there, Alan, just reminded me of...
John Wick.
No, I, amongst other things, I subtitled in the past few months, TLDR, I had to subtitle the Hellboy movie with David Harbour.
The new one?
It is not good. But the Baba Yaga in that is shit. It's really bad.
I don't even remember Baba Yaga in that. Do you know
it's fucking awful. But now that you've mentioned it, I realised I meant to mention this on a previous podcast because I could not believe how bad that movie is. It is like a pilot for the worst possible TV show. Next to nothing happens in it. And the story is so thin.
The only thing I remember is when the demons like come out of the earth and one of them grabs a guy and uses his sword like a kind of cheese grater.
Yes.
That is the only bit I remember from that whole fucking film. That and they bring in Abe. at the very end, like a post-credit scene.
They do. They tease Abe at the end. Good luck with that sequel. That's never going to happen. Yeah. Thank fuck. Oh, it's so bad, man. I could not. I was prepared to, you know, it might not be Guillermo del Toro's version, but I'll give it a chance. David Harbour seems like a decent actor, and he seems like a good guy. I want him to do well. But, oh my God, it's not good. It is not good. And the character of Hellboy just does not seem like Hellboy. And he's not even a remotely interesting character. There's nothing about that movie that is good. Anyway, that's got nothing to do with it. It's just because you mentioned Baba Yaga. I had to get that off my chest. That movie is fucking terrible.
As you mentioned Guillermo del Toro, how about his new one? Something about
Nightmare Alley.
Yeah, that looks great.
Not seen it, but... I have to be honest, Guillermo del Toro is hit and miss for me. When he hits really well, but when he misses really fucking badly.
Yeah. It's got a really white cast.
It does.
More like Whitemare Alley.
Did you ever see Crimson Peak?
I didn't see it.
Don't, because it's honestly one of the worst pieces of shit I've ever seen. Really? And it was at that point I was like, okay, Guillermo del Toro can really make absolute fucking garbage sometimes. It's awful.
Did you watch his TV show, The Strain?
I've seen the first few episodes.
Fucking amazing.
Really? Okay, so I've heard very mixed reviews about that.
It's fucking nonsense. It would be filed under absolute ducking
nonsense. Utter ducking nonsense.
Yeah. But it's great, great laugh.
Cracking good laugh.
Other than that, I've been catching up on She-Ra and the Princesses of Power, which again, can't recommend highly enough for our listeners. It is, for a kids TV show, it's full of depth. It's totally heartwarming. It's super well written. Noel Stevenson, the showrunner, really knows what she's doing. The characters are immediately likable.
Mm.
It has everything that Kevin Smith's Masters of the Universe Revelation is not. And it's all the better for it. I've not even watched the second half of that shit.
Neither have I.
I've not even
watched
the second episode of that shit. Like, that's how much I've watched of it. I watched the first one and was like, this isn't great. And then heard yous going how shite it was and went, oh, well, fuck it then. Life's too short.
But that's all my TVs of late.
No, it's not. You also watched Cobra Kai.
Oh, yes. I watched that in such quick succession, I almost forgot about it. That was how I spent New Year's Eve, watching season 4 of Cobra Kai.
Season 4 of Cobra Kai is a lot of fun.
Absolutely brilliant. My second favourite season thus far, I think.
Maybe same for me. I don't know about you, but unexpectedly, I am really loving Terry Silver. Thomas Ian Griffith, the actor who plays him, is great, man. He's so good. And I think it's really fun how they took probably the most maligned entry of the Karate Kid series, and certainly the most maligned villain, and they've made him not quite a three-dimensional character yet, but he's at least two-dimensional, which is definitely one more dimension than he had in the Karate Kid 3.
From the trailers, I'm getting big Ric Flair vibes, like just with the white hair and just...
What's interesting, though, is he's playing a much more subtle version of that character, which, thank fuck, because he plays a cartoon character in Karate Kid 3, which is why initially I was like, do you really want to bring that character into the show? But that guy's great. He's solid in this season, and he's playing a character that seems real. I mean, the show is nonsense. Let's just be honest, it's nonsense, but it's enjoyable nonsense, and it does its thing just right. It's a show that remains way better than it has any business being.
Absolutely. The guy that plays Terry Silver, he has a line that basically just describes Karate Kid 3 and sort of explains it away.
I remember I messaged you about it, it's like, that is my favourite line so far.
Where it's just like, Karate Kid 3 was ridiculous.
I should have been obviously top of the world in the 80s, but I was so pumped up on cocaine and revenge that I spent weeks making a high school teenager's life hell all for the sake of a karate tournament. It's like, that is pretty much what Karate Kid 3 was. It seems ridiculous to say it out loud now. good shit.
If you've not seen it, no spoilers for the twists and turns it takes.
Not just the physical twists and turns.
I mean, we can overlook the fact that the cast are getting on a bit now, that, like, you know, Miguel's a full-ass grown man.
Yeah, and Daniel's son is now going through the Henry from the Americans phase. Yes. And I liked how they recognise that by having Johnny not recognise him, say, who are you?
It's like, oh, and he says,
growth spurt, you ever heard of it? Pretty good.
That's great. But yeah, highly recommended. It's continuing to be great.
So my only other bit of TV watching lately is at the time of recording, Euphoria has just finally begun its second season, and I watched the first episode last night. It's lost none of its intensity, that's all I'm going to say. And the other thing I'll say is, one thing this episode tells me is that what the Euphoriaverse really badly needs is a spin-off show all about Fezco's gangster grandma. The episode begins with Rue telling us, and I quote, "Fesco's grandma was a motherfucking G." And then the next few scenes, yeah, they pay up. They pay up on that promise. It's incredible. It's just like a mini gangster movie for like the first 5 to 10 minutes. So yeah, look forward to see where the usual harrowing territory that show goes to.
It'll continue to be a laugh a minute.
I was
going to
say, it'd be all sunshine and rainbows, right? Like, just nothing bad will happen to anybody. Happy endings all around. Can't wait.
That's what I want from my TV. Shows where nothing happens. And no emotional ups and downs. All right, well, I think that probably wraps it up for another edition of fSobriety TV.
Toodle-pip.
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 Good ep. Good ep.
Good ep. Those guys sure know about recent television.
They sure do. I was thinking, James, as we were wrapping up on our end of year extravaganza, we recorded our end of year extravaganza just on the cusp of a whole bunch of very notable people dying, and we normally like to mention that kind of thing, so I was thinking we should probably... Wait, is this an episode of Press F Sobriety, the podcast, in which we press F to pay tribute to recently deceased celebrities, artists, and other admirable individuals?
Tragically, I think it may be.
Cue the music. So yeah, in the last month or so, 2021, holy shit, that year went out like a motherfucker. Who did we lose, guys? We lost a whole bunch.
We lost Betty White.
Finally lost Betty White, just very shy of her 100th birthday.
Finally, like a bit fucking tight.
Yeah, so, at last!
I can't believe Keith Richards beat Betty White.
I know. Shocker, isn't it?
But yeah, icon, gone. Press F for Betty White. We also lost Greg Tate, who I was super upset about. I mean, he was only in his 60s. Greg Tate, for anybody who's not familiar with Greg Tate, is a great cultural commentator. He was a writer for the Village Voice for like since the early 80s. He was one of the main writers that really took hip-hop seriously in the 80s and approached it in the same way that he approached his jazz criticism. He approached it with that same level of, you know, making the American public realize that this was a serious art form. But I've seen a lot of people describe Greg Tate in their obituaries as he was the hip-hop writer Greg Tate, which on the one hand is not wrong, but he was way more than a hip-hop writer. I mean, he was writing about jazz before he started writing about hip-hop, and he was also just a great all-round cultural commentator. And if you followed him on social media, as I did for years, he was incredible. Like, he just had great, thoughtful, deep things to say about whatever was going on any day of the week, you know. Yeah, an incredible voice. It's fucking tragedy that he's gone. Obviously, Desmond Tutu also gone. And, you know, the fucking shit libs and neoliberals wasted no time and given their mealy mouth fucking, oh, we should all be like Desmond Tutu and
call for peace should be.
And all the rest of it. It's like, yeah, you guys should be because you literally still support apartheid in different parts of the world, you fucking clowns. Yeah, it's a lot of disingenuous bullshit going on where that's concerned. We also lost Robbie Shakespeare, one half of Sly and Robbie, and James, for regular listeners who enjoy her occasional sojourns into F's of reggae, where I try and cajole you into a fondness for reggae music, which I know you're very resistant to, but even you, I am sure, have some appreciation for Sly and Robbie, because they did
absolutely
do so much work for the foundations of dub, and have had such a major influence on the musical landscape ever since the 70s.
Yeah, they were like always prevalent. Even as I was growing up, I was always aware of their existence, and, you know, Guy was an incredible musician too. So
yeah, and a visionary. I mean, a great producer is, and there's two sides to Robbie Shakespeare. On the one side, he was one of the musicians who really made a foundational sort of, when you think of what the bass sounds like in reggae, Robbie Shakespeare was that guy that made it sound that way. Everybody emulated Robbie Shakespeare. And as a producer, you know, he was an absolute genius. He was up there with Lee Perry, really. I mean, if you look on the Sly and Robbie discography that lists everything they ever did, both as session musicians and as producers. It's crazy how fucking long that is, and crazy just how many artists they worked with. Every artist pretty much you can think of they worked with, because outside of reggae, they worked with people like Grace Jones. They even worked with Bob Dylan in the 80s, you know. Yeah, it's crazy. I mean, they worked with pretty much everybody. And so now we're down to just Sly Dunbar, which is sad.
Everyone fucking form a protective circle around Sly Dunbar.
Protect Sly at all costs. We also lost, interestingly, James, which I thought you would have made note of this one, but Jean-Marc Vallée, who is the director of Big Little Lies, he also died in December.
I didn't even know that.
No.
Yeah, and apparently his cause of death is unknown. Seems a bit mysterious.
Did he fall down a flight of stairs?
Yeah, Zoe Kravitz shoved him down a flight of stairs, case closed. She said to him, "That's what you get for not accepting Andrea Arnold's actual cut of the second season." That's a hip reference to some behind-the-scenes banter about season two of Big Little Lies.
Press F, though. We're not claiming that he was murdered by Zoe Kravitz, just in case anyone's...
No, she was hard at work on the set of Batman at the time. She's got witnesses.
The only thing Zoe Kravitz has been known to murder is her outfits every time she rocks a new outfit.
Nice. So that wraps it up for another edition of Press F Sobriety. Toodle pip.
Well, good ep. Those guys
should
know a lot about
good celebrities. Those guys know a lot about dead cunts.
those vultures sure know a lot.
Yep, let's cash in on those dead guys.
Yeah, I'm gonna put them in hashtags. It's going to be amazing. Yeah, get us more followers.
That's how it works. What would Elliot Alderson say about that?
Let's find out. Mr. Robot, Season 2, Episode 2, Unmask, Part 2. Written and directed by Sam Esmail.
Oh, yeah. Better get used to that grid.
Yes. Needle drop. Game, set, and match by Glitter Bitch.
I thought you were going straight for the call.
The note is there.
Well, of course it is.
Tune.
Scott Knowles is off to deliver the money in the park. He has an awkward standoff with a pedestrian at some point, which is hilarious.
Yeah. It's like this is the first time Scott Knowles has ever had to walk between normal people.
Yeah,
like,
totally.
One of the poors is walking their dog.
That is absolutely the vibe.
He is 100% fucking Tory in this scene. It's like instant regret. He's like, what the fuck am I doing?
Yeah, a bit off more than I can chew here. I didn't realise there'd be actual human beings out here, the human filth, the unwashed.
Agent Smith vibes in it, it's the smell.
I mean, it just goes straight to Phil Collins in my notes.
It does.
So
it changes straight to Needle Drop, Take Me Home by Phil Collins. What a tune. It just builds through this scene. A scene with this much tension in it and that's the background music is fucking genius.
What I think's kind of cool about that, though, is that Phil Collins does have a bit of a cultural reputation as being sort of part of the synthetic 80s. That's sort of part and parcel with the yuppie era, which leads me to start associating my mind with Oliver Stone's Wall Street, which then starts making me think about Mary Harron's American Psycho, which then makes me think about Tyrell Wellick. So in some weird chain of association, that's kind of where my mind is at.
It's funny because he does have that sort of 80s Wall Street, big shoulder pads, suits like yuppie plastic, adult-orientated rock association for a white audience, but
yes,
he's apparently well loved in the hip hop community.
And right.
I remember hearing like a documentary on Radio 1, I think it was, back in the olden days. There's all these like rap artists and hip hop producers talking about how influential Phil Collins was, and I was like, is this a joke?
Are you all trolling me?
They fucking loved it. I was like, what's going on here?
It's like the drum break in the air tonight or whatever the fuck that song's called. They all seem to really love, right? Like just
do 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 do. that was a joke no one outside the UK is going to get.
I can hear it coming in the Queen Vic tonight.
Oh no.
Merry Christmas, Ange. That's an even more fucking niche reference to EastEnders from the 80s.
We've got absolutely off the rails here.
These outtakes are going to be good.
This is all staying in. This is gold.
Is it Wainwright gold?
So, Scott Knowles, back in Mr. Robot, whew, but he thinks every commoner, every pleb that he sees has got to be...
Well, that's it. Every lower than middle class person, they all look the same, don't they? They all look a bit shifty. That's where Scott Knowles is mentally.
And the security team were like, is that them? Shall we go? Shall we go? But Scott Knowles is being a big brave boy and saying,
yeah, he's got his big boy pants on. He's saying, no, I chose to do this mission. I'm going to see it through to the end. I'm going to own fSociety.
But no, he now, does not own fSociety.
I have a whimsical note about this. When this bike courier turns up, I don't know why I always think this, but I think this, if anything, when a bike courier turns up, I want it to be Michael Smiley's character from Spaced.
Tires.
Yes. Can you imagine that guy just rolling up to Scott Knowles and just talking to him high speed about inane bullshit? Missed opportunity, Esmail.
Everything's fine. The only thing that's getting me is these fucking mood swings.
I mean, thematically, it fits in with Mr. Robot.
Bicycle courier comes up, the security team are like, are we going to move in? And he's like, no, no, no. And yeah, the courier is just like, are you from E-Core?
Yes. Yeah. Are you from that band, E-Core?
Yeah.
Please sign here.
The acting by Scott Knowles.
He's fantastic.
When he's opening that bag, it's fucking amazing.
So good.
It's like, oh God, is there a bomb in here? Holding it at arm's length. But lo and behold, no. No bomb, just the end of the world, to quote the flyers for the end of the world party from mm-hmm. the end of season one. Inside is a mask, and attached to the mask is some lighter fluid.
Yep, and we've got a wee message saying, wear me and burn it. Wear me and do a KLF.
For those of you who are unfamiliar, KLF, British band from the 80s/early 90s. A couple of artists, Bill Drummond and Jimmy... Help me out here, Jimmy Cotty?
Jimmy Cotty, yeah, you were right.
Who were, you know, quote-unquote art terrorists, as well as being a band. My favourite thing they ever did was when they played at the Brit Awards. Mm-hmm. Sorry, quote-unquote played at the Brit Awards. But they, instead of playing, they had... Fuck, who was it they got to play instead of them? Extreme Noise Terror.
Extreme Noise Terror, yeah. It was like some... I knew it was like Grindcore, somebody great. And it wasn't Napalm Death, so it would have to be Extreme Noise Terror.
Fucking amazing. But as an art project, they burned £1 million on a beach once, which no one really knows if it was an actual million
now,
pounds.
To their credit, I have to say, this still causes controversy to this day, because there's people who are right into the KLF who were totally outraged by that, and there were other people like, oh yeah, that's right on, it's like a major anti-capitalist statement. And then there were some people, I think I'm somewhere in the middle, where I'm like, it was a fun spectacle. And they were kind of making the point, which is, and this is very Mr. Robot relevant, that money kind of isn't real, you know, because money only really has meaning when its use and its distribution is dictated by people at the top. People like those cunts in E-Core. So I'm using the word cunt in the Scottish sense. I don't mean it in a misogynistic way. I feel I have to keep explaining that. Particularly for you North American listeners, I know you only ever hear that word in an explicitly misogynistic context. We don't use it that way here. So these cunts from E-Core.
E-cunts.
I feel like what the KLF are doing is sort of making a similar statement to what Mr. Robot is sometimes making. It's just an interesting... I do wonder if Sam Esmail was channeling that, but I don't know if this is something that's widely known outside the UK, the KLF stunt.
If anyone's going to know it, I think Sam Esmail would know it.
Probably, yeah. Yeah, he does seem the type. Consider some of the needle drops and whatnot, it's quite possible.
For the record, The White Room is a fucking banging album still.
It is good, yeah.
It's great. They were one of the purveyors of what was called stadium techno at the time.
Right, aye. And they also approached everything they did like in a kind of like post-situationist way. Like everything was like a sort of stunt where it was part joke, part political statement. I mean, some of the stuff was legitimately clever, but it was always that grey area between how much it's trolling and just being an idiot for the sake of it and how much it's actually making a political point.
Yeah, because they did that like Doctor Who song and shit.
Right, yes. Which yeah. I'm not going to lie, that song's a banger, yes, man. Yep. I still love that song. The TARDIS.
Hey! Oh man, if that's on Spotify, that's definitely on the...
Oh, it's got to be. Did they call themselves the Time Lords?
Yes.
So anyway, we are not being paid by KLF for any of this. We have gone way off the rails.
If we were being paid by the KLF, we'd take that money and burn it.
Burn it in front of them.
Much like Scott Knowles has to do, because he gets a phone call
from a distorted Darlene
saying, if you don't do what it says in the next 10 seconds, we will brick every E-Core bank.
Yeah, and I love this moment. And again, the first time I watched this show, this was another one of those moments. Like, I can't believe I'm watching a show that's actually going there. This is great.
He puts on the fSociety mask. He tips the money out. People stop to watch what's happening. And they watch this guy in a suit with the fSociety mask burn $5.9 million.
Which, again, the way it's shot and everything is just such a great visual. And all the metaphors at work just in the imagery, it's so good. Fucking chef's kiss for that kind of thing.
Yeah.
I also love just how quite frightening Scott Knowles' face looks behind the mask when you just see his eyes.
That's what
he
I was
looks
just
properly
about to say.
Sinister.
Yeah.
When he pulls the mask off and he has that expression of pure horror in his face, like...
Yeah, and defeat. He realises he's defeated in that moment. It's a powerful moment.
He can't win. He can't buy a win in this fight. He's got nothing to use against fSociety in this, but he realises it when he's just watching the money burn. That's his life. That's it. His whole soul is just up in smoke and there's nothing he can do about it.
He's up against an enemy that he can't buy off, which is, you know, that's like the most terrifying thing to someone like him. First time I watched this, and even now when I rewatch it, it's just so thrilling to me that you know, we get to see this on television and such great filmmaking to bring it to the screen, that the protagonists of this show are people who are legitimately fighting against capitalism. I never thought I would live to see something like this. It's just crazy. I mean, and amongst all the other great stuff this show does with all the other themes and all the psychological stuff, which is equally great, the fact it's got all this stuff on top is just never stops being exciting. All right, so let's catch up with Philip Price, the aforementioned scene with Price and the meeting up with the government officials, and they're trying to convince Price that he should resign. And it's a great line here where Price says, "You have something right there." And, the guy says, "I'm glad you see my point." It's like, no, like, on your face.
It's the utter disgust in his face when he says it as well. It's just like...
It's the tone of voice Michael Christopher uses as well, like he's talking to a child. It's like, not on your face.
You might as well have just said, "You fucking idiot."
Who's on first? No, that's what I'm saying to you.
Oh, amazing. But the dialogue in this scene, the kind of negotiation that's going on here, is another it's another area that sort of underlines what I was saying just a moment ago with regards to how the KLF thing ties in with Mr. Robot. Here you see kind of explicitly them talking about ways in which you can just rejig the economy, because again, money's not real, you know. Yeah. But there are things that you have to do. There's rules that you have to play by. And as far as these people are seeing it, it's like Philip Price at least has to be seen to take the bullet. And I have to say, as much as I hate everything Philip Price stands for, A, this is a great moment by Michael Christopher. He's so good in this scene. And there's that weird part of me. It's like, yeah, you go, Philip Price. And then going to my, and then saying to myself, what? No, fuck that guy. But it's just because this performance is so good and it's so well written. But he's telling them that rebuilding the database is the only solution. And I love that he's hammering that as well, because it's also kind of the relationship between the illusory nature of money and also the illusory nature, literal illusory nature of digital data, which is really all the money is in this case. Because the only reason any of this happened is because all of E-Core's data has been encrypted. And it really, the show is constantly drawing your attention to this idea that paper money still exists, but it's fucking meaningless, and it's always been meaningless because it's all dictated by this abstract data. And it, even before things were computerized, that was always the abstract part of capitalism. That's always the abstract part of the economy. And it's ultimately what governs people's lives.
But even that, right? Like, it's like, oh no, it's based on the value that we've placed on metal. Sorry, what? Like tin and shit. Well, yeah, but also gold. Yeah. Uh-huh. Like, and how is that worth anything? Like,
yeah, I mean, all these things are so arbitrary. It's just, yeah, I mean, the whole thing is a nonsense.
May as well be tulips.
That's the kind of line that Philip Price could even use in this scene and it would work. But it's another instance here where I remember making this same note several times when we were discussing the first season, James. I think I said it about Terrell as well. Both Terrell and Philip, to different degrees, are like the honest voices of capitalism in this show. And I would say probably this moment, other than the scenes between Price and White Rose, this is maybe the scene where it's most explicit in the series.
I've made a note here that Philip Price is doing the full-on late-stage capitalist manifesto right now.
Right, yeah, literally. But it's the one you don't let the public hear.
Exactly,
But it's exactly what's been said behind the scenes. And it's the quote that you mentioned earlier, as long as the con works, people will buy and sell whatever we want them to. And if I resign, any scrap of public confidence will be destroyed. A con doesn't work without confidence. And
so
this is the moment I was mentioning, like the score underneath this scene, there's like a weird sort of patriotic yay kind of thing behind it, which I think is an ingenious choice because it's so brutally ironic. Considering everything that's going on, and in another show that same piece of score would be used in an exactly the same kind of scene but for the diametrically opposite reasons, but Sam Esmail's using it in a completely different way that we've never seen before and I don't think we've seen since. It's insane, man. It's just so great. But if this is your best idea, I shouldn't be the one resigning, and wipe your goddamn mouth.
I love that we do find ourselves rooting for Philip Price in this.
It's so bizarre, because he's a horrible piece of shit.
Yeah,
but
he's the worst.
He's such a well-realised character.
Even later in the show, when he becomes a slightly somewhat more sympathetic character, he's still a complete bastard and he's still the worst, but the way he's written and the way he's portrayed is just, it's just a guy you want to see get one over on these other bastards that you can
ruin. If there's some other arsehole that can be defeated by this guy, then I want that guy to be the weapon that can be used to destroy these other people. Absolutely. It reminds me a wee bit of, it's no secret, I don't think any of us like George Galloway, right? George Galloway is a terrible human being who has cosplayed as a socialist for about 4 decades, when in actual fact he's just an absolute opportunist and just a political fucking braggart and idiot.
IRL Scunner Campbell, motherfucker.
But one thing George Galloway is good at is being an in-your-face orator the way Philip Price is. And do you remember when George Galloway was at Congress, or the Senate rather, what's it called? House of Representatives, where it was about the whole oil scandal. And George Galloway ripped them all a new arsehole about the illegal war in Iraq, the illegal war in Afghanistan. I hate George Galloway, and he's a creep, and he deserves to be there, but at the same time, I was like, that's exactly the guy I want to be saying this shit, because this is fucking brutal. And you know that nobody else in the kind of liberal sphere in the US will ever get up and say that shit, but George Galloway will, because he realizes he's threatened, and he has to unleash all the big guns. And I remember at the time thinking, this is great television. George Galloway is awful, but this is great TV. All right, so meanwhile, first appearance this season of Joanna. And it's how we like to see Joanna playing S&M knife games with her hapless bar jockey friend, pound shop Tom Cruise and cocktail, doing a reenactment of what I'm calling Bret Easton Ellis's adaptation of David Lynch's Blue Velvet.
You know, we've seen Joanne loves a bit of the old S&M before, but
partial.
She's in the traditionally sub role.
Yes.
But she's always the dog.
But she's nonetheless in control.
Yeah.
A power bottom. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, this guy, Patsy written all over him. Not the only Patsy in this episode. We'll talk about another Press F later. But yeah, I remember the first time I watched this. I remember, now here's another area where Sam Esmail kind of pulled the rug out. Because I remember thinking, oh, this guy's going to die at some point. When in actual fact, season 3, fuck you, Esmail. Pound shop Tom Cruise kills Joanna in season 3. It's like, fucking hell. But the thing is, when you think about the logic of what Sam Esmail has done in this show, we should have seen it coming. Because a big part of the story of this show is that powerful people are not untouchable. and that their chickens do kind of come home to roost. So Joanna was kind of writing her own death warrant with this guy from the start. And as much as we love Joanna because we love her as a character, there is this sense that, well, you know,
she's a piece of shit.
At some point, the worm is going to turn. She is a piece of shit. Yeah, her and Terrell are both awful. Yep.
But she is amazing at the same time.
But they're both just such great, great, brilliantly realised characters. The show sort of uses our appreciation for how well these characters are presented as a way to disarm us when they're finally taken away from us, because we think, oh, that terrible person's gone.
Yeah.
Like, with any other show, it's like, oh, thank fuck, that person's dead.
And when she is gone, we really feel for Terrell as well. Like,
right.
Oh,
and why? Because, I mean, Terrell's fucking terrible. But yes, he gets his wee boy face on again and starts greeting, and we're like, oh, poor Terrell. Poor little fucking homicidal psychopath.
Do you know who needs Sam Esmail's magic? Prince Andrew, right?
Oh, fucking hell.
We're living life in the jizz lane. What we're saying is Prince Andrew is definitely a rapist.
I'm getting the word nonce.
That's nonsense.
Sorry, we kind of we were talking about something else, and then we started talking about that. That was a bit of a non sequitur.
I think that might be joke of the episode.
Imagine feeling sympathetic for that non-sweating motherfucker. That would be a hell of a piece of writing.
Oh, heavens to Burgatroyd.
God, I hope I'm not driving through an underpass anytime soon after this goes out.
Oh, Jesus. Right, okay. So this is definitely the final episode of fSobriety.
Thanks for listening, guys. Press F for all of us.
Press F for fSobriety. MI5 are all over this podcast. Thank you guys for downloading. We appreciate your listenership.
Anyway, from a sub-dom situation to a dom sub situation.
Holy shit, you are on fire. Dom buying herself a turkey sub, that's nice. So yeah, Dom in the house, first appearance of Dom DePiero. The only FBI agent we've ever liked, apart from maybe Dale Cooper. I guess Albert Rosenfield.
Albert.
And to a lesser extent, Gordon Cole.
Scully.
He's never really an X-Files guy.
We've talked about this before.
We have.
But Dom, who is going to be one of the most important characters in the show...
Yeah, although you would not know it from this episode.
Yeah.
The most underwhelming entry, yeah.
What I know about Dom is she likes a lollipop, a turkey sandwich, and she can swear in Persian.
Yeah.
Yep.
Skills.
And that's it. That's all we see.
That literally is all we see. She swears at a guy in the queue. Then she goes to the FBI headquarters. And we don't even see what she's doing at FBI headquarters.
But the lollipops that she takes are beside some celebrity magazines, the cover of one of which has Inside the Glamorous Wardrobe of Terrell Wellick's Wife on the cover.
Right,
it's another just subtle but beautiful little piece of world building.
Yeah, and also, it's a stab at the way that that sort of culture works, you know, and it's always this endless fetishizing of terrible people. Like, on one hand of the media is like, oh, you know, this person did this terrible thing, but hey, isn't his wife kind of hot? And it's like, we have such a weird dichotomous thing going on in their culture.
They're not wrong, though.
Look at this murderer's wife's jacket.
Right, yeah. Check out this party she attended. Look how great she looked. Look, who else was at this party? The answer is probably Jeffrey Epstein.
Yeah, just don't go onto the roof. Yeah. So yeah, she goes to see our pal Gideon, who's still having a totally normal one. And that's it. She just walks in, Gideon looks...
Yeah, like a lost little boy, like he did in the previous episode. But more important things going on. Elliot's watching the basketball. Things are really hotting up in the Elliot front, aren't they? Jesus. Yep. I can see why people love this show. See that Mr. Robot last night? Oh, the main character spent 2 hours watching basketball. It was amazing.
Yeah, we get a little sneak hint of just how much of a badass,
Joey
pun intended,
badass.
Leon is here.
You literal badass. Yeah, there's a standoff moment, which again, should have told us that big prison vibes.
Yeah.
Because if this was really out in an open court, these guys would just fight. Why would they not just fight? You know?
Yeah.
But yeah. All right, so I guess we have to shout out the great Craig Robinson here as Ray.
The Pontiac Bandit.
Pontiac Bandit, yeah. I love this guy. He's so good.
He's amazing.
And I think there's something quite ingenious about taking an actor who's best known for comedy and casting him in what turns out to be a villainous role, because you're completely disarmed by it.
And so villainous as well, in a series full of fucking horrible people. Oof.
Right, yeah. I mean, he turns out to be involved in some horrible, horrible shit. But it's the Pontiac Bandit, man. It's like, that guy's funny. He's Jake Peralta's buddy, man.
Fun fact about Craig Robinson. Before entering show business, he was an elementary school music teacher in Chicago.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That makes so much sense.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's a great turn by him here. He's so great. I mean, he's so great at acting the unoffendable nice guy here. Mm-hmm. Like, everything Elliot does, it's just water off Ray's back. He's just like, all right, I'll keep trying. He's like, he just comes across as being a nice guy who cares.
Do you mind if we keep
this
conversation?
Season goes on.
Like, no, that's some cold shit.
But as this season goes on and he turns out to be what he is, it's like, holy shit, all along this was actually an ingenious portrayal of an actual villain, because, and we've discussed this before on the podcast, this is what bad people do. Bad people generally are very good at appearing to be good people. And that's why they get away with a lot of terrible shit a lot of the time.
And again, it's that thing, he does mention it, he's like, it's all about perception and, you know.
Yes, yeah. There's a lot of clever shit going on in the dialogue in these scenes. And the fact he's got such a big cute doggo as well, which does a lot of the work here.
He talks about his wife and stuff. It's just, he seems like a wholesome, kind of like fun community guy who walks into the basketball court with a set of keys and puts them away.
Right, yeah. I mean, okay, we are fucking dumb, right?
I don't know if you noticed, but he points at one of the players. He's like, oh, they've put Bradstreet in. This should be a strong game. It's like, but Kyle Bradstreet must be playing.
Good old Kyle Bradstreet, yeah. Writer on the show. Yeah, it's always fun when they do stuff like that. You know what's really great about this scene as well is Rami Malek's performance as Elliot in this moment. He's at his most reserved and most self-protective. And the chemistry between, or non-chemistry between him and Craig Robinson is automatically hilarious. And so that helps, I think. It really it hides Ray's true intention. We, as viewers, we're not looking at it. We're not even suspecting there's anything amiss about this at this point. I mean, we can understand why Elliot is standoffish, but Ray, for all intents and purposes, just comes across as a good guy. We are seeing Elliot in this moment through Ray's eyes, and Elliot in this moment does just seem like a hilarious oddball, an unintentionally hilarious weirdo. And it's quite ingenious that the show does that at this point, because we are so used to seeing everything from Elliot's perspective, like 99% of the time. So everything, the way the writing just completely disarms us for that, Craig Robinson's performance, you know, he's very warm, very jovial. It's great casting, it's great performance.
You'd love to be his pal, wouldn't you?
Yeah, I want to be Craig Robinson's pal. Sorry, I just realised we're mispronouncing his name. He's Craig. American, so it's Craig Robinson. For you North American listeners, by the way.
Oh, now we know who they're talking about.
It's not how you pronounce my name, right? It's Craig, with an A, not an E. Why you guys pronounce that as if it's spelt with an E? I don't understand. But anyway, I'll get over it one day.
Spoiler, Craig wouldn't get over it.
But as if Ray has that speech that you mentioned earlier, James, about Maxine just sees a bunch of dumb animals playing basketball, but they want you to see badass homies. The question is, which is the truth? All possibly none. Maybe there is no truth. All we think is what we've got, which at this moment puts Ray right in Elliot's mental sphere, because this is the kind of shit that Elliot is dealing with right now. It's almost like Ray is reading his fucking mind. I do always lol hard when Ray utters the line, not the loquacious type.
Yeah.
But the TLDR here is Ray has some kind of computer issue that he wants Elliot to look at, because he's heard he's good at that kind of shit. Elliot tells him he doesn't do that anymore, and that's when Ray starts telling about his wife. His wife said he'd make a friend today. Is it cool if we continue chatting? And Elliot's like, nope. And then that's the line that you mentioned earlier. I was like, damn, that's cold. I'm going to have to go listen to Adele on repeat when I get home.
But I love, as soon as he mentions the computer, Mr. Robot appears like, go.
Yes, yeah, I've been summoned by a mention of computer. You said the magic word.
I dream of Christian Slater.
I mean, don't we all?
Yeah.
And he Mr. Robot wants out of this analog nightmare. And it's like, why didn't we figure out how has he kept him in an analog nightmare when he's just walking around the streets?
Right. But Elliot, once again, he's letting us know he's more concerned with just preventing Mr. Robot from taking control, and that's the only thing he can think about right now.
He has a line that he says, something, no matter how much of an illusion he thinks this is, you're like, motherfucker, this is an illusion and you made it. This is amazing.
Yeah,
and then he
yeah.
walks past a church. There's like a little kind of church thing that has a sign outside that says Isaiah 41:10.
Yes. It's one of two biblical references in this episode.
Isaiah 41:10 is, do not go far from me, for I am with thee, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. Yea, I will help thee. Yes, I will uphold.
Uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. It's big Mr. Robot vibes. I mean, it's big. It reminds me very much what Mr. Robot was saying to Elliot towards the end of the first season.
In Times Square.
Yeah, you were supposed to be my prophet. I was supposed to be your God. And there is this sense that Elliot, the other, I suppose the other double meaning it has, or triple meaning if you like, consider we're into layers of metaphor here, is that when you look at it in the context of where the story goes ultimately at the end of the fourth season, there is also the idea that the hand being withheld currently is the real Elliot, and that, you know, there is this other godlike presence, if you like, in the sense that they're the one who should be in charge of the world. The real Elliot's the one who should be in charge here, but currently is absent. Yeah, there's a lot of interesting stuff going on there. I always dig it when Mr. Robot does the Bible references. I'm actually quite into that shit. I think they're always chosen really interestingly. And they're usually fairly subtle. I mean, this one's hell of a subtle. You could easily miss this one.
Yeah.
I mean, it is just written in the background. You could easily miss it. There's one that's a bit more explicit later. Okay, so we segue from that. There's some chat show silliness. Everybody's talking about Terrell. Everybody hates Terrell, that famous show.
This is an American political commentator by the name of Nancy Grace, who, unlike Obama, did actually do these lines for the show.
Oh, really? Okay, yeah. That's interesting.
This is not the last American political commentator who did lines for the show, but more on that later.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah.
So Pound Shop Tom Cruise.
Changes it to Vanderpump Rules.
Yes. Ask Joanna if she wants to watch. And it's like, have you met Joanna?
Which I had to look up. I was like, there can't be a real show called Vanderpump.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. 9 seasons so far.
Yeah. Because, of course.
My ex loved that shit. Loved that shit.
Really?
Like, oh, man.
Was your ex Joanna Willock?
Yeah. No.
But yeah, Pound Shop Tom Cruise is trying his best to get Joanna to act like a human being. You want to come for a drink? And she's like, no, we don't exist on the same planet, you fool. I have to return to my lizard people. Mr. X arrives at the door. That's what I always call him. I love this guy.
Yeah, he's amazing.
That so face, good. Man, is pure carved out of granite. It's amazing.
Jeremy Holm is his name,
And
Sutherland is the character's real name.
Yep.
But I'll just always call him Mr. X.
Because it suits him so well.
But I love the way he just barges past Derek. Like he's not even there.
He barely acknowledges him now.
One side simp.
Yeah, so you said 2 o'clock, it's 2:15.
Out the bath, Joanna.
Come on, Joanna, get it together. Get yourself dry, 10. But even the way he steps in on Joanna in the bath, like he's not even moved by the fact that Joanna's naked in the bath. Like they've got a relationship where he doesn't even see her as human anymore. It's like, this is my job now. That's all I am, my job. It's like he becomes a robot in the role of his job. But that guy is great. He doesn't get so much here, but one of the things the show does brilliantly with his role is the way he just sometimes has those moments of humanity. Like, it's a great one towards the end of the first season where he starts talking to Elliot when Elliot's doing the hack in towards the end of the last season. It's like his subconscious mind just starts coming to the fore in Elliot's presence. And it's little moments like that. I love it because he's such a stoic presence for most of the show. Yeah, it sort of makes me wish you got more of him. It does. It's one of the reasons Joanna's death makes me sad is we no longer get that dynamic anymore from that point of the show, but oh well.
It's a good sort of driving Miss Crazy sort of dynamic they have.
You are on fire tonight.
This French wine I can't pronounce is really fueling the wall engine.
Oh, monsieur, with this French wine I cannot pronounce, you're really spoiling us.
Meanwhile, everyone hates Angela.
Everyone hates Angela. That's the other show we've got going here. Everyone hates Angela. Subtitle, Angela does not give a fuck.
Yeah, I mean, to be honest, if it's to somebody in your work who's like, I'm going to go and tell the boss on you, like, would you give a fuck?
Well, what's interesting to note here, I think, is in the space of a month, Angela has really rocketed up the ranks, it looks like. And she is also taking her job at ECOR 100% seriously. Like, this is where she wants to be now.
Okay, nepotism is a hell of a drug.
Right, am I right? Yeah, behind the scenes nepotism is the worst kind. Yeah, I mean, she has drank the ECOR Kool-Aid.
Yeah.
And that's the big message from this episode, I think, where Angela's concerned. I don't know about you, the first time I ever watched this, I was shocked at this, because I remember the first time I watched the first scene with Angela here, I remember thinking, is there going to be some... I was expecting there to be some sort of, you know, a reveal that she's...
She's talking to one of the other members of fSobriety with, like, an earpiece in. Like,
right.
Sure,
you said fSobriety.
Yeah.
It's fSociety.
fSobriety.
It's like something's come alive.
fSobriety is the organism overtaking Mr. Robot. But I was kind of expecting there to be some sort of reveal that she was kind of doing some skullduggery behind the scenes to still take down Evil Corps, but no, she has drank the E-Corps Kool-Aid at this point.
The scene that really hit it for me was later when she meets with Antara and IR, and I was like, oh, here comes the reveal that she's still working behind the scenes, and it's like,
that's,
oh no.
That's exactly what I thought. I was like, okay, so...
There was a reveal, not what we were thinking, though.
Here's what I found out, but no. Yeah, it's... Dark. This is dark stuff. I mean,
closing line to her is like she tells the kind of joke or whatever, and it's just like, fuck.
Yeah,
that was cold, man.
Yes, yeah. But call you're the word that she does not use and we won't use, but yes. She makes it clear what she means. Yeah. So yeah, this fucking annoying colleague of Angela's saying, "You're terrible at your job. I'm going to go tell what's her boss's name, Melissa, her supervisor."
Yeah.
She's negotiating with the media, with Bloomberg on the other line, playing hardball, like really taking a big risk here. And then them saying, we need to discuss everything in full. And then she's like, no, I'm not going to happen. And then they say, well, we need to at least talk about James Plough or the Pound Shop Kilroy, as we discussed when we talked about season one. And Angela says, eventually agrees to one question only, but she has to approve it. Holy shit, she's good at this.
Yeah. Fueled by pulling the heather, no less.
Right, okay, this is the other note I had. This is the second time we've seen now that when Angela needs to power up her villain energy, she powers up on Sonic Youth.
Sonic Youth empowering capitalism since 19-whatever.
What is Sam Esmail trying to say here? Alt-rock sold out in the mid-90s.
At least it means we can put another Sonic Youth song into the jukebox that's not just a cool thing.
Although, in fairness, right, this is from, like, Sonic Youth. This always makes me laugh when I look back at those albums, because I remember everybody saying at the time, this is Sonic Youth going a bit commercial. Listening to Bull and the Heather again today, there is nothing commercial about this song. It's so fucking weird. It's such a weird song.
That whole album, Experimental Jet Set, Trash and No Star, is a fucking
weird crazy
album.
Yeah, it's just not as crazy as some of the other stuff, but I think there's an argument to be made, because it pretends to be pop in places, that actually makes it a bit more radical. But yeah, it's such a weird song.
I was listening to it when we started the call, and I couldn't remember why I was listening to it, and that was why I was listening to it.
Side note, Experimental Jet Set Trash and No Star was the first Sonic Youth album I ever bought.
Really?
And the only reason I bought it was because I read a Nirvana interview where they talked about Sonic Youth, and I was like, oh, I should check out this Sonic
Youth. Like a lot of people your age did the same thing.
Yeah, and I went into like HMV or Virgin or one of the two, and I was like, I wonder if they've got an album by Sonic Youth, and I was like, oh, they've got a lot of fucking albums. And I took it home, I was like, this does not sound like what I thought it was going to sound like.
This is not verse, chorus, verse. What is this? Anyway, this is not a Sonic Youth podcast.
Sonic Plouf.
Holy shit. Right, that's it. You're not the next two episodes, you're not allowed any jokes.
I've used up my quota.
Experimental Jet Set, no brains, am I right? R.I.P. Pliv.
Impressive. But I love when she's on the phone to Bloomberg and they're like, oh, we wanted to ask about James Pliv. And she says, come on, no, we're not talking about that. He killed himself on live TV. We need to show some respect for the family. And they're like, respect? It's been a month.
Yes.
Pure media arseholes.
Yeah, but Angela gets her way, ultimately, and then Melissa eventually comes over, and Angela just in time updates her, anyway, I'm going to go get more coffee. Yeah. I did enjoy the interim bit when the office narc tells her that she's going to go get Melissa. Angela's delivery of, tell Melissa whatever you want right now, but get out of my fucking cubicle. It's yeah, like, holy shit, you've literally turned into female Patrick Bateman.
So
Patricia
cool.
Bateman. Patricia Batewoman. No? All right.
Meanwhile.
Across town, Joanna finds a mysterious wrapped gift on her doorstep. Yeah, it's funny now, looking back on this, knowing where it's going, that it ultimately turns out to be Scott Knowles trolling Joanna.
Scott trolls?
Scott trolls. All right, I give up, man. I give up. You've got all the jokes, man.
I'll stop.
Scott trolls.
Carry on.
Anyway, so Joanna unwraps the gift, and we've got a wee music box with a phone taped to the bottom. That's what we see. And that's about the size of it. Once again, I love the way Esmail shoots the kitchen here, which is where we see this. Again, it's one of those big cavernous rooms, which I'm sure looks bigger than it was in season one.
Is that maybe to give the impression it's because she's alone in it now?
I think that's exactly, yes, I think that's exactly it. So the space of the room is filling the frame and she seems insignificant in the frame. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's again, just beautiful filmmaking. While we're on that, we'll just skip ahead, actually, just to talk about the other bit we see with Joanna. So later we see Joanna just looking at the music box and it's tinkling away, and the baby cries and Joanna goes to attend to the baby, and we just see the phone ring when she's out of the room. So somebody's in contact. Now, back in the day, of course, we were being led to think this might be Terrell.
Yeah.
But it is, in fact, the newly named Scott Trolls. This long game that Scott plays here, what a fucking arsehole. I mean, okay, I know your wife died and this dickhead killed your wife, but
get over it.
I just it's mean that this is a cowardly game. I feel like if Scott Knowles is the big man, he should be playing a better game than this. It's not even a well thought through plan. I think that's what strikes me on the rewatch. I'm like, this is a weak plan. There's no way Joanna was not going to figure this out.
No, he's clearly not the big man by any stretch of the imagination. He's the wee dick.
Yeah, I mean, I'm remembering the state he ends up in towards the end of the season, where he is just like guzzling his wine that he loves to chat about, unlike nobody else we know. And he's just like Bernard Black at the end of this season when Joanna goes around to see him. It's a hip reference to the British sitcom Black Books, written by notorious TERF Graham Linehan.
Oh, really?
Yes.
One of the most divorced men in entertainment.
Yes. Of all the divorced men, he is the divorcedest. It's my favourite thing every time Glenner posts shit online. I mean, he's no longer on Twitter, but when he was on Twitter on his transphobic rants, it eventually became a meme because somebody just started saying to him, divorce going well, is it, Graham? And then everybody just started replying to him that way from then on. Divorce going well, is it?
Lawrence Fox gets hit with that patter a lot as well, and it's great every time. It's hilarious.
Oh. All right, so back with Angela. You mentioned it before, but she meets up with Antara Nair. I love Antara Nair because I love that actress, Sakina so Jaffrey. Good. She's so good. This show is full of great actors, but she's like one of the most naturalistic people on this show. I feel like that's literally who she is when she's on the screen. Mm-hmm. And I've seen her in other stuff, and it's like, oh, spoiler, actors can be different people. But she just seems so fucking believable in this role. It's like, holy shit.
And again, she seems like the sort of person you wouldn't mind having a wee hangout with as well.
Yeah, she seems cool. I kind of wish her and Angela remained pals, because Tara Nair actually seems kind of cool.
Yeah.
For a lawyer. I mean, she's fighting a good fight, as lawyers go.
But as we discussed already, big Kool-Aid drinking from Angela.
Yeah, Angela's doubling down on it, makes it writ large here, tells us, the audience in the process, no, this is who I am now. I'm not quitting. I like my job. I'm good at this. But the other thing this communicates to us is this, it really lets us know, and we discussed this when we were talking about season one. Season one gave us a lot of insight here and there into who Angela was, in terms of that she did think very little of herself, that she felt that she was kind of going nowhere in life. She wasn't taken seriously by other people, and that her relationship with her old pal Ollie, when that all came, went the way it did. There is this sort of feeling, Angela, is this just who I am? Is this going to keep happening to me? Am I just one of those people who's constantly losing? And now for the first time, she feels like a winner. She realizes there's something she's actually good at. And guys, this is how they get you. This is how capitalism gets you.
That's why I'm glad I'm not good at anything.
This is how we win, Alan.
Exactly.
We win by continuing to lose. And at the end of the day, isn't that the real winning? To quote Leonard Nimoy in The Simpsons, the answer is no.
Yeah, so before she leaves, Antara does like a elongated burn.
Yeah, the aforementioned elongated burn. It's harsh. Yeah, it's pretty harsh. But the thing I'm glad about is that this line comes from another female character, because if it came from a male character, it'd be like, it seems gross. But yeah, because it comes across, the result of that scene is it makes the thematic and, I guess, political point without the misogynistic aspect there would be if a man had said it. So yeah, it's a good piece of writing.
Plus, I'm not sure if this is what happens, but it looks like Antara just like, before she says that, she arrives at the bar, she doesn't even order a drink. Before she leaves, she just picks up Angela's drink and tans it.
She does, yeah, I noticed that as well.
I drink your milkshake.
Yeah, and then this guy sits down next to Angela and gets snared.
But yeah, so she takes him home, does what two consenting adults do, and then gets up in the middle of the night to listen to her
positive affirmations. Yeah. Everything about this is gross. I hate this. To form new neural pathways. My confidence is powerful. I recognize myself as exceptional. I will follow my dreams no matter what. Providing they are capitalistic dreams.
Yeah, it's like manifestation for capitalism is fucking
it's gross. I hate grim. This shit. It reminds me of something we spoke about way back, James, when we were talking about Fargo season 4. If you recall, when What's-His-Tits Carnegie turns up. It reminded me of all of the self-help bullshit, which is ultimately just the birth of corporatism. All of that self-help shit really is just where corporatism began. Yeah,
was that at the dinner table scene in the hotel?
Yes. Meanwhile, across town,
back at the totally normal basketball.
Oh, where are we, guys? Oh, basketball is it? God, this show is amazing. I wish we got more basketball. If there's one thing I wanted from my prestige TV drama, is guys watching other guys play basketball. I tell you, this is high octane shit, isn't it? This is my favourite show, can you believe it, guys? It's just non-stop guys watching other guys play basketball. That's how we should sell it to people from now on. You seen that Mr. Robot? Oh, you should get into the second season. This guy watches other guys play basketball. It's incredible.
Yeah. And our Ray having a chat again. Same shit, different day, same Ray. And poor Elliot at his most bug-eyed is like, look, man, I don't mean to be an asshole, but, you know.
Yep.
Ray's like, So this is last night.
This is a classic Mr. Robot bra moment when Ray says, but we talked last night and you seemed cool. And Elliot says, I don't know what you're talking about. We didn't even talk last night. And instantly, all of us watch and go, oh, shit. Yeah. Mr. Robot's up to fuckery. And I do even like, and again, this is one of these lines you don't even need to put in. But because Craig Robinson delivers it so well, when he just looks at Elliot and goes, huh, you really don't remember.
And we get that Elliot panic walk and talk where he has this whole monologue again. And again, he says, my perfectly constructed loop. It's like, it's still preparing us for season 4.
On rewatches as well, though, I'm feeling like Sam Esmail is literally just laughing at me, saying, I told you countless times in these first two episodes that this was not real, you fools.
Yeah.
You fucking idiot, you moron.
And by the time you get to the last episode of season 4, you should have known this was what was happening all along as well, because I painted it in big letters.
He says, Elliot checks his journal, realizes he has a gap in his consciousness occupied by quote-unquote sleep, and he realizes Mr. Robot has been in control. That explains why Elliot always looks like he's fucking knackered. Dude doesn't sleep. Sometimes my mask takes over. Smoking! Somebody stop me from taking down Eco!
Yeah, and then up pops our old pal right at that time, Mr. Robot, asking Elliot what he thinks people see when they see him coming.
Right, when they look at you, they see me. Yeah, it's great shit. And it's maximum panto evil Christian Slater in that moment as well. So great.
I love how powerful it is though, because for a couple of seconds, you're like, he's got him. Mm-hmm. Mr. Robot's got him. Mr. Robot wins. And then he's like, oh no.
Rami Malek does the impossible here and makes himself look more insane than Christian Slater with this madcap laugh.
How did he not get cast as the Joker after that? How did Jared Leto get cast as the fucking Joker and fucking Rami Malek didn't?
Irrespective of anything else, how the fuck did Jared Leto get cast as the Joker?
Yeah, Elliot's having a totally normal one, and
it goes on for so long as well.
And this is where we get the thing I referenced earlier, where, oh yeah, Mr. Robot can't believe what has just happened. Much like Scott Knowles, he sees he's got no control at this point. He can't.
Yeah, yeah.
Can't even.
He can't intimidate his way out of this. He's just hitting a brick wall, and he's like, oh no, this cunt's more mental than I am.
Yeah, this is really where we get a sense for, and what will become a main theme in this season, that Mr. Robot and Elliot, or Mastermind Elliot, are really evenly matched, and any one of them can take control at any moment. And that's really what we get a sense of here, that Elliot's not just a victim, he can take control. There are ways he can defeat Mr. Robot, but it really is such a stalemate, and it's kind of setting us up for that whole chess game that they do a few episodes down the line.
Yeah.
God, it's great shit. But I do love Elliot's exit from this scene. I'll wait for my church group. Peace. It's the ultimate pawn. But meanwhile, across town...
Oh, this is the other thing I was talking about earlier. On the television is NY1 senior business anchor Annika Pergament.
Okay.
Real life news anchor. But this isn't the only time she has portrayed herself in a TV show. She was also in two episodes of Netflix and Marvel's Daredevil as herself on TV.
Oh, wow. Oh, really? Yeah. Okay.
Yep. So, you know, so Mr. Robot is in the MCU.
Mr. Robot is officially part of the MCU. Yeah. Weird that all the heroes just let 5-9 happen. Just never mentioned it to each other.
Doctor Doom crying is like people can't pay their bills.
Doctor Doom on the street handing out cash to people outside the E-Core bank branches. Here you go. It's in Latvian currency, so I know you might need to go to the Bureau de Change first. I may not be the best help in this situation, I'm sorry. I have some Doombots that can fuck up the people inside the bank for you, if that helps. No, actually, no, that's a bad idea. I'm trying to turn over a new leaf. Yeah, get ready to hit that F key, because Gideon's in the bar watching this news story unfold, and this guy who introduces himself as Brock, and frankly never trust anybody called Brock. Who the fuck good has ever been called Brock? No offence to any Brocks listening, I'm sure you're lovely. Brock on. I'm sure you guys are solid as a Brock. Whoever it was, is who sang that? R&B soul classic. It's a Brock. Who sang that again? Ashford and Simpson.
So Brock starts off. Brock's a fucking like absolute like precursor QAnon motherfucker, right? Brock is right, so cute at heart.
Yeah.
But he starts off talking about all these hacks.
Yes.
And I wonder, are all those hacks related to White Rose's machine and the Dark Army doing it? Because the places that have been hacked all seem to line up with the idea of White Rose trying to get her machine moved or online.
I guess it could be, yeah, because it's an unanswered question, I suppose. It could be, yeah.
I should stick to the jokes, man. My points are shite.
No, it's fine. It's actually a good point. I hadn't thought about it, but it's worth thinking about. Brock tells Gideon that they're essentially reliving the Great Depression. This is another one of those moments where I think the show is driving home this idea that when something of this magnitude happens, what's next is either war or fascism or a revolution of some kind. And it can go any of those routes, but something major has to happen. And Brock is somebody who's clearly feeling that anxiety and is feeling a certain way about it. And he starts to voice this idea that Gideon is, he even uses the term crisis actors.
Yeah.
It was certainly a buzz phrase back in the mid-2010s. I feel it's not in as common use now. So Brock is sort of doing the come on as well, trying to make it seem like he's trying to hit on Gideon. And Gideon is resenting it because it reminds him, married, but Brock correctly calls out, press F for Harry, because even though he's not dead, we're never going to see him again. Because he's apparently left Gideon in amongst this shadow of shame and ignominy post the 5-9 hack. It all got a bit too much for poor Harry, which is a shame, because there's one thing I know about Harry, he was a good party host.
Yeah, well, he's going to live with someone who's got a working doorbell, because he's...
Right, well, that must be it, yeah. Somebody who doesn't live in a fucking bank vault for some reason. That really annoyed me. But if for some reason you're only listening to our Mr. Robot coverage from season 2 onwards, I did have a bit of a rant about what a shit host Gideon was, because why did he not tell him he didn't have a fucking doorbell? That seems like the kind of thing you should mention. Fuck's
also
sake,
apparently
Gideon
told his husband, when referring to his work colleagues, by their fucking employee yes, numbers.
Yes, like, what the are you a fucking robot? What's happening here?
001, 01.
Gideon bot does not compute. All that said, however, Gideon still does not quite deserve what happens to him here. Gideon Goddard, we hardly knew ye. This is not a nice way to go out.
Brock says, I'm going to be a hero.
I'm going to be a hero tomorrow for taking out this crisis actor. Who's he a hero amongst all the other head cases on whatever fucking bizarre message boards he's frequenting?
He's going to be a hero in fucking 4chan, basically.
Right, aye. Or 8chan.
Yeah.
Oh, Gideon. Although it's not the last we see of him, we do see him again in a couple of different capacities.
We do see Gideon again a couple of times.
He's going to co-star with an icon of... US 1980s TV in a few episodes time. So at Elliot's church group, the woman running the church group, she is reading from, and I'm sure this is a shock to nobody, it is of course from the book of Revelation, and it is from chapter 21 of the book of Revelation, which contains the accounts of the new heaven and the new earth, which is followed by the appearance of the new Jerusalem, the bride, as it's described. And it's the whole idea of, after everything essentially being destroyed in Judgment Day, that the good will come afterwards. And all those who deserve to survive Judgment Day will find themselves in the New Jerusalem. And so it's kind of drawn a comparison, I guess, with the idea that fSociety are working to create a new world. And certainly Mr. Robot in these two episodes is being the voice piece for that. Kind of trying to get Elliot back on that train. Certainly trying to get very... evangelistic about the glory of that idea. I do enjoy a good Bible verse sometimes, particularly when it comes from Revelation, because holy shit, Revelation's a fucking ride, guys. It's great.
So if you've never read it, give it a swatch. Like, I'm completely atheist, but it's a fucking...
Yeah, same.
It's a lol.
But it's a great read.
Some bro dropped some mushies and wrote that shit, and then someone was like, oh, this must be the future.
Just the language used is so poetic and so vivid. I mean, yeah. I copied a piece from this verse here, and just this one sentence I really love. And he said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give from the spring of the water of life without payment. And I like that because it also, it's got kind of an analogy to the whole economic situation as currently presented in this show, yeah, as well as the actual sort of spiritual and apocalyptic vision. There's so much going on. It's a really brilliantly chosen Bible verse. But wherever Bible verses pop up in this show, I think they're always really brilliantly chosen. And then mysteriously, Elliot suddenly finds himself back at Magda's on the phone. And there's a voice on the other end. Is that a voice we recognise? Let's listen closely. Are there any clues? Bonsoir, Elliot?
And there we come to a conclusion of season 2, episode 2.
On mass part 2.
All the twos. So, Craig, how would you rate this episode on our Mr. Robot-based rating scale?
After considerable thought and deliberation... Mm-hmm. Weighing up the pros and cons.
Yep.
I think one can only fairly assess this episode thusly. I am scoring this episode 9 5s out of 9. It's another perfect episode, slam dunk. To the shock of no one.
My goodness. Well, gird your loins, guys. For I am also rating this episode 9 5s out of 9. A perfect episode of television. Season 2 haters, get in the bin.
Yeah, Season 2 haters, you need to have a word with yourselves. I mean, I'm trying my best to be a bit diplomatic about it because I want to try and convince you. But the problem I've got is I don't see why I should have to convince you. You get it?
The haters can't see, but I'm actually holding up my score for this episode.
That's two birds from Alan Todd.
Two false flags out of two false flags.
Two crisis actors. I mean, it's perfect. I don't understand. What was it you wanted, guys? What was it you wanted? Get on our socials and let us know. Moreover, I think once you've seen the whole series, exactly how the story was told in Season 2 makes even more sense. Yeah. I mean, it's more perfect than it was. I don't know how you can approach it on... I certainly don't know how you can approach it on a rewatch and not appreciate what's being done here. I don't know. I'm mystified as to why there's so much hate on this season. To me, it's fucking perfect.
Oh, it's incredible. I can't wait. There's points in this series that I can't... On this season, I should say. I can't wait to discuss.
That's another reference that you were making there to that classic 1980s thrash metal album from Slayer, yep. Series in the Abyss.
Dead Skin Unmask.
Class War Ensemble.
Yeah. Anyway... Having said all that, let's take a moment here to thank the listeners. Even those listeners who might be a bit shaky on Season 2, because I'm sure you're going to watch along with us anyway and reevaluate your shitty opinions.
Yeah, that's the way to convince them that their opinion's wrong. Tell them they're shitty. You guys suck.
You're wrong. Your opinions are wrong.
We are good at diplomacy at fSobriety.
Yeah. Quick shout out to listener David, who made us our fSobriety 22 YouTube Subscribers Award on his...
That's amazing. It's
on
great.
His 3D printer yep. that he got for Christmas.
It's fabulous. We really appreciate it. It's such a nice gesture.
Yeah, we do not want any more YouTube subscribers. Thank you very much. We're happy where we are.
Yeah, we don't want that to be obsolete, so...
But yeah, wherever you are, thank you for listening. Thanks for sticking with us. We hope you're enjoying the fact that we're back on Mr. Robot. Like I said, our next episode, we had originally intended on alternating episodes about Mr. Robot and then getting back on Twin Peaks: The Return, but you're going to have to wait.
Yeah, you have to wait one episode more. So basically what's going to happen is, for you guys, first of all, who are here for the Mr. Robots, which I assume is all of you since you're listening to this, the idea is to alternate. So the next Mr. Robot episode will be... 3 episodes from now.
Yeah.
And we're going to make a pattern of alternating our Mr. Robot rewatch with our Twin Peaks The Return rewatch. So for you guys who love our Twin Peaks Return coverage, and I know there's literally some of you, that will be alternating. So 2 episodes from now is when you'll get our next Twin Peaks The Return coverage. The episode in between, i.e. our very next podcast episode, will be the aforementioned Yellow Jackets Season 1 review.
Listen, it's not our fault. We did not foresee Yellow Jackets being so fun that we had to do an episode about it.
Yeah, we got bowled over by it so much that we just kind of decided there's no way. If we mention this in the podcast, it's going to be a whole episode. So we just decided to bite that particular bullet.
Till then, if you like what we're doing in any capacity, why not leave us a like or a comment or a review on your podcasting platform of choice? Tell a friend, tell several friends. And yeah, we'll be back next time with our Yellow Jackets episode. But I think that just about wraps this episode up, right?
I think it might do. And I don't know about you guys, but I'm just having a wee look at my glass here. And some would say that it's one part of the old Cadbury's Dairy Milk catchphrase, and it's not a glass and a half, it's only the half a glass.
As you can see, my bottle here...
I mean, it's more. You've got less than a half it there, but for the purposes of this bit here...
For the purposes of this bit, I would say that it's probably roughly roundabout...
To paraphrase Flint from Action Force / G.I. Joe.
Fuck it, that's half the bottle. Toodle pip.
Toodle pip.
fSobriety, Episode 31, Class War Ensemble, was conceived by Craig Woods, Alan Todd and James Hamilton, edited by James Hamilton, and is a production of Half the Bottle. The theme music is Colossal Estates by Errors, available on Rock Action Records. Break out of your analog nightmare and connect with us on Facebook at facebook.com/fSobrietyPodcast, on Twitter at fSobrietyCast, on Instagram at fSobriety, or search YouTube for fSobriety Podcast. but don't bother subscribing. All the music mentioned on the podcast can be found on the fSobriety Jukebox playlist on Spotify. Also, as per, fuck Spotify. Does anyone know how to recover a deleted email?
Wait a minute. Guys, is this an episode of fSobriety? Nope.
Nope.
You've got to remember, though, it was acceptable in the 80s, so...
What was that?
So you've got to remember...
a Calvin Harris joke.
It was acceptable.
Just definitely getting cut out.
Oh, I see.
Well, thank heavens for that.
Bob Saget, but...
Tumbleweed.
Yeah, I know, but yeah, I couldn't have cared less of that one either. I just remember reading it.
And on that note, that wraps it up for another edition of Press F Sobriety. Toodle-pip.
F Sagatti. Yoga Flame. Oh no, wait, that wasn't Sagat.
Man, you get the laughs out of this. Ah, fucking hell. Legitimately jealous of that sub dom dom sub cut joke. That was formidable.
You're welcome. There's that little bit of hope for Joanna. Is this an episode of fSobriety?
Alright, I am resigning.